We are already in session. We had an executive session ahead of this meeting, so we are going to continue on. We do not have to call to order. So right now, opening the meeting, we do not need to do roll call. We've already done it. I need an approval of minutes, item A2, from the special board meeting of February 16th, 2016, special board meeting of February 29th, 2016, and the regular board meeting of March 1st, 2016, special board meeting of March 9th, 2016. I need a motion.
So moved.
Second.
Any conversation? Nothing? Okay, Mr. Gaynor?
Mr. Posh?
Yes.
Mr. Register?
Yes.
Mr. Silverman?
Yes.
Ms. Wright?
Yes.
Mr. Zucker?
Yes. Okay, we can move on to item B. We have no requested audience, is that correct? Okay, so we will move on to statements from the audience. And I have them here, 1 second. Okay, so thank you again for being here. We have quite a few statements from the audience tonight, and I'd just like to make a couple of just announcements in terms of the statements from the audience. We always allow people 5 minutes to speak. We try and keep them to the 5 minutes so that everyone gets to say what they came to say. I do see that a lot of people are speaking on the same thing tonight. Not tremendously surprising. What I'm gonna ask you is we will still give you 5 minutes, just like we always do. We would request that if you are able to keep it as short as possible, that would give everyone the chance to speak. If you hear someone else say something that you are going to say, again, if you're willing to give up your turn, that's great as well. But again, we will give everyone a chance. I think today, also, I think it might be wise for me to tell you who's up and then who's on deck so that the person can come up so that they're ready for the next person to speak. So with that, we're going to start with Tamar Gray, and she's here to speak about reductions. And on deck would be Brian Shaner to speak about reductions.
No?
Yeah.
Okay. My name is Tamar Gray. I wear many hats in this district. I'm a resident, a taxpayer, assistant pastor, a music teacher in the Heights system for about 25 years, and I'm also second vice president of Local 795 Teachers Union. I thought I would speak to you tonight about losing highly skilled staff, but this you must already know. Instead, I will talk to you about what the students are losing. These cuts will affect our final product, our students, we say, who we want competing in a global society. What happens with our mission statements, our vision statements? What about strategic planning that has been so thoughtfully constructed in every building? Not to mention buildings that are focus schools who are making progress. The investment and time and effort should not be swept away with the stroke of a pen. We stand before you with the realization that administration believes in the choices that they're making. We have been told that it comes down to numbers and bottom lines. Those of us who've been around for a while know that the numbers will change. Bottom line should not just come down to money in a community where students are valued over financial projections. In the 17 years I've lived in Cleveland Heights, I find this to be one of the many strengths of our community. We say our students are our top priority. If we truly mean this, we will make sure that every effort is made to keep class sizes down and to give them the small teacher to student ratio relationships that will not make them just a number in a large class. Our students do deserve a top rate education and staff available to meet their many needs. We are fighting for them. It is shown by studies that more teachers are needed, not less. There's an obvious attack on public education that we are already fighting. We do not want to have. Thank you. We do not want to have to fight this from the inside out. I can only hope that you move as quickly as possible to call back as many of these educators and support staff as possible. We realize as a district, we want to start off with a strong show of educational force in the fall. We want to reassure the community that more thought was put into this decision. Our students are the most important factor in this complicated equation. We ask that you reconsider tonight not to cut so deep. This is within your power. Some of these educators may find jobs in other districts. This will be to our loss because of the money, time, and investment that has already been placed in them. not to mention the working relationships that they have established across grade levels and throughout the district. They will be well prepared, but our students will lose out. It is about the students and making an impact on their lives. So with students, parents, community, all of these people out here, all of these teachers and staff, we want you to know we stand together. Thank you.
Just 1 second. So on deck is Tina Reynolds and Beth Ray. Sorry, Brian. And
Brian Good Shaner. Evening. I am Brian Shaner. I have lived in Cleveland Heights for 30 years. I am a science teacher at Heights High School. My sons attended Heights schools from kindergarten through the 12th grade, and I am the first vice president of the Cleveland Heights Teachers Union. I am acquainted with all of you and have spoken with you at one time or another. And I need to tell you that your administration's plan to change the staffing of this district is a mistake. First, no parent anywhere ever said that they were happy to hear that their child would be assigned to a larger class. Parents know. Parents know that adding children to a classroom reduces the amount of space that they can occupy and reduces the amount of time that their child can expect to claim their teacher's individual attention. Parents are not wrong about this. It is just basic physics. While the class sizes plan may not fall outside of the state of Ohio's guidelines, you may have noticed that the state of Ohio's Department of Education has turned into a source of continually changing guidelines and unfunded mandates that are more related to a certain political philosophy than to educationally sound practices. The state's guidelines are drawn so that even the most minimally adequate district should be able to meet them. Minimal adequacy is not a suitable goal for us. Minimal adequacy is not a suitable goal for a district that is working to guide its students to their highest levels of achievement, particularly students in lower grades and with special needs. Second, the plan breaks with the longstanding practice of this district in terms of staffing. The chief justification put forward for this plan is our declining enrollment. What has not been mentioned is that the teaching staff has also declined by roughly the same percentage in the same time period. The cuts that you are proposing slash deeper than the declining enrollment would call for unless there has been a significant change in this board's philosophy. Fundamentally, you seem to be saying that public schools like ours should no longer strive for the small class sizes that only the wealthy can otherwise afford in their private schools. You seem also to be saying that our teachers have been lazy up to now and that a further cut of over 10% in this teaching staff can be absorbed unnoticed if only the remaining slackers will pick up the pace. Thirdly, the cuts at the high school where I teach will materially affect our students and the educational program there. For example, there seems to be the impression that teachers are fungible. That, for instance, if a person has a license that says they are an art teacher, that then they can teach any course that you choose to label art. This is not so. When an art teacher leaves, she takes her unique skills and talents with her, and the students who had hoped to study with her will not have the same experiences they had counted on. You may say that we will maintain our programs, but this is simply not true. They may sign up for a course of the same name, and the teacher there will work very hard, but it will not be the same experience. We have had an emphasis this year on encouraging students to take AP courses at the high school, yet you are riffing the AP chemistry teacher. Did you know that it takes a teacher a couple of years of experience to become really good at teaching a course they have never taught before? especially one that requires independent training and independent study on the teacher's part. You are giving that experience away, and I guarantee you that some district will be delighted to get it. Finally, it is not the teacher's contract that is forcing these cuts, as has seemed to be implied by some. The contract provides a procedure for cutting staff, but the fundamental decision to cut any position at this time is entirely yours, and I hope you will reconsider. Thank you very much.
And, Fiona Connor's on deck, and just if you'll just glance at me, I'll give you a 30-second sign if you're getting close, just if you think you're getting close. Thanks.
Please worry about the time. It's okay. We've timed our speeches, and it is well within your limits.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Good evening. Tina Reynolds. I'm a kindergarten teacher at Boulevard. I'm also the fifth vice president of Local 795. I represent elementary teachers. I've been a Heights resident since 1962. I'm a Cleveland Heights graduate. I have two children who are Cleveland Heights graduates. This is my community. I started teaching in 1984. In our years at Cleveland Heights, we've seen staff cuts that resulted in the loss of some of our best and brightest teachers. Everyone's investment in time, professional development, and relationships are lost, and we start again. We feel that way today. Research supports that teaching is about building relationships, not just with our students and families, but with our colleagues as well. While this is important for all schools, it's particularly true for our neediest schools. Our teams spend hours working on STEM back maps, IB planners, and countless other tools to organize instruction to meet student learning needs. We plan instructions and interventions and talk about how we can help our students and each other. It takes a village, and for us, that village is our building staff.
And I'm Beth Ray, started here in 1978, fresh out of graduate school. I am the sixth vice president representing elementary teachers in Local 795, and I teach at Noble School. We are connected to this community and have been for over three decades. We know our families do not want increased class sizes. They know that it is difficult for us to do the job of educating their children without the support of experienced stakeholders who we know have poured their hearts and souls into supporting children. We also know that the community wants fiscal responsibility, but is cutting 50-some teachers in one fell swoop, those who directly impact students, the best way to achieve this goal? President Klein has put together a sensible and coherent response to the layoffs that speak to different and proactive ways of looking at these issues. And we urge everyone in this room and everyone up here to read this document and urge the Board of Education to reconsider these drastic measures. Thank you.
Patty Smith is on deck.
Hi, my name is Fiona Connor Kuntz. I'm a resident of University Heights by choice with 16 years as a district parent, 18 years as a district resident, 21 years as a Cleveland Heights teacher. And I'm currently the union steward at Garrity. I'm speaking against the proposed reductions in teaching force from a broad and historical perspective. My main concern is the use of averages. If we use the projected decline of 800 students over 10 years, that's an average of 8 students per school per year. If each school loses only 8 students next year, how can that equate to a reduction of 49 teaching positions? Another concern with averages is that students are not evenly distributed across the district by age and geography, which has been a stumbling block in previous attempts to streamline our educational services. Unless the district plans to use flexible boundaries or assign some students to a school which is not their neighborhood school, the proposed teacher reductions will potentially amplify inequities and inefficiencies across buildings. Using average caseloads for intervention specialists is especially problematic. State and federal mandates limit an IS with a self-contained class of students with autism to a caseload of 6, for example, or 8 for MD or ED. So these caseloads skew the averages below the 16, which an IS for students with mild disabilities is allowed. The higher our district average goes, the more likely we'll have ISs at or above their caseload. It's also critical to remember that caseload does not reflect all that an intervention specialist is doing in a school. Interventions with general education students who are struggling, along with support for general education teachers, is very labor intensive and over and above actual caseload. As caseloads increase for an elementary IS, it is very difficult to provide the legally committed IEP services. There are multiple grade levels, needs in a variety of subjects, and often programs which have to be delivered with fidelity to a small number of students. 16 students may be allowed, but in reality, 16 IEPs may not be able to be serviced. The high poverty in our student population and the intake of students who may have been out of school for a period of time or in multiple schools or have entered kindergarten with no preschool experience are just some of the reasons Cleveland Heights University Heights schools cannot be in the business of smoke and mirrors averages, but must instead staff our schools to meet individual student needs, which continue to increase. I respectfully ask you, our school board members, to require our administration to demonstrate down to the individual student within a building how appropriate caseloads, class sizes, and course offerings can be maintained before voting to approve these reductions in the teaching force. Sweeping statements about averages and teachers stepping up are not, in my opinion, an adequate illustration that the proposed reductions will not affect the education my own children and every other child in the Cleveland Heights University Heights schools will receive next year and beyond. And finally, as a University Heights resident and levy voter, I share our community's voice concerns about the top-heavy staffing at Miramar. So it seems irresponsible to me for the school board to approve the proposed reductions of teachers before we hear the administrative cuts which the community has called for repeatedly. Thank you.
Ari Klein is on deck. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Patty Smith. I'm an intervention specialist at Monticello Middle School. I live in the community and I've been a teacher in the district, a special ed teacher for 17 years. I am deeply concerned about the cuts that have been made to the special education department. 15.5 positions were eliminated out of 95. We lost 3 in our building alone, and 2 of them are our behavior specialists, whose children need the continuity and the consistency of a teacher. Over the years, this job has changed in many, many ways. There is more than double the non-instructional paperwork now required, multiple documentation for meetings, behavior plans, and interventions. Larger class sizes means this non-instructional paperwork increases and time is taken away from instructional planning for students. The saying now is in our district, we are more than test scores. And while our caseload numbers may be under what the state recommends, there are faces behind those numbers. And that is the more that we are talking about. We have approximately 18 to 19.5% special education population out of 5,400 students. Our students are coming to us with much greater needs. Emotional needs, academic needs, and behavioral needs. The idea that increasing class sizes and caseloads for intervention specialists while promoting and expecting higher test scores as benchmarks for success seem to be concepts that are at odds with each other. I urge you to look into and reconsider your recommendations to lay off our dedicated intervention specialists. Thank you.
Corrine Nickel is on deck.
My name is Ari Klein. I'm the president of the Cleveland Heights Teachers Union. I've been a math teacher in the system since 1988. I'm a parent of a graduate and a current senior and legal guardian for a freshman at the high school. I'm also an alum K-12 of the school system. My parents, wife, and our siblings are graduates of the district as well. My daughters are the fifth continuous generation to live in the Heights since the 1920s. I believe I know what our community values. As an example, I know that our community supports staffing levels that best allow students to thrive. Reductions of the magnitude in tonight's agenda do not reflect these community values. I think it's also important to point out it is rare for our teachers' union to organize and protest publicly concerning what is clearly administration's right in determining the fate of the district. We work closely with administration and all the time, collaborating to solve problems from a perspective of shared goals. That is why this current decision is so disturbing. We believe it is our obligation to speak out when we believe the choices administration is making will harm our children. We have tried to change the course of these current events, but could not keep silent as this set of reductions goes forward. In January, the forecast from Treasurer Gaynor showed that current levels of staffing for next year would not put the district at a deficit, even though it would necessitate the passing of a November levy for new money in 2017. If there are reductions to be made, they should be made with great care. A precise scalpel method could be understood and reasonable, but instead, we got a loose chainsaw. Tonight, you are hearing from several teachers among concerned parents, students, and other community members. We ask that the board demand that administration go back to the drawing board and look at all the information with a new lens. There needs to be a change in the premise made that came up with these reductions. We are very concerned about the number of apparent mistakes that have been made as this set of reductions was created. We've compiled a document that's in your hands, except for you, Gaynor. You don't get one. Sorry. So you can read it over. They are extensive. This document also lives online at chtu.org for anybody who's interested in looking at it at the top of our webpage. They include the number of letters sent to the wrong people to not accounting for electronic classrooms. There are mistakes that are clear violations of our contract. There are mistakes that challenge common sense. There are mistakes that create inequalities between schools. Most of this would not have occurred had the reductions been reasonable. In fact, it is unlikely most of us would be here this evening if it was reasonable. It is not acceptable. If administration wants to do this correctly, they need to talk to teachers who are in the classroom to see what goes on across the district. These practitioners do the heavy lifting of the district and can supply a wealth of information, if asked. Staffing decisions should be based on this reality, perhaps over 2 or 3 years, to ensure that we are not losing important assets. You have a choice. As a community, we will hold you responsible for your decisions. Please do the right thing and hold off so we can avert the damage that will be difficult to undo. Thank you.
Nancy Eisenberg is on deck. Thank you, Corrine.
Good evening. My name is Corrine Nickel. I'm a 10th grader at Cleveland Heights High School, and I have currently 4 siblings in the district and 1 sibling who will be joining the district once I've graduated. Most of the teachers here are already talking about a lot of the effects that this will have on students, but I'm going to give a personal story because I think that's going to be slightly powerful. I was devastated to hear that my freshman English teacher was getting riffed this year. Not only is she a lovely and wonderful person, she's also an amazing teacher. I learned so much from her, and she gave me so many opportunities, and opportunities that were given to me despite the fact that they meant that she had to do more work than she had to do. The cutting of teachers, it doesn't really matter for me because I'm going to be gone in 2 years, but my siblings are still going through the system, and my siblings will feel this. If we're going to ignore the fact that we are letting go of wonderful people and making them scramble to find jobs, we should also realize that these people are amazing teachers and that our students are losing them. When I heard this decision, I thought that it didn't seem like the school board and the administration had thought very much about the effect this would have on students. And when we're thinking about a school, the student should be the first priority. I don't think our decisions that are made about our schools should be made based on saving $3.5 million. That's something a corporation or a company would do, and this is not a corporation or a company. It's a school. Thank you.
Patrick Brandon is on deck. Sorry, Nancy.
Hi, I'm Nancy Eisenberg, and I am the department liaison at the high school for the visual arts. And there are students who feel like they are not successful or smart or worthy in core content classes. The expressive arts are a way that schools can help connect to these students, as the arts not only allow students to shine in talent, but they also provide students a healthy outlook for their emotions. To take that away, to take that away is to sacrifice the very students who are already most at risk. Over the past few years, our numbers have tripled in the art department. We have 608 students who have signed up for art for the 2016-2017 school years, which is up from around 400, which we service this year. We are gaining students. We are not losing students in the art department. Past practice has always been supply and demand. This school year, we had to turn away students because we did not have enough teachers to fulfill student requests. The demand for class exceeds our current supply. The visual art department at Heights High currently has 4 art teachers, each of whom specialize in the field in which they deliver instruction. Our students leave us and enter into art-related fields, vocational programming, and art schools, more college and career ready, as a result of learning photography from a photographer, jewelry from a jeweler, studio art from a painter, and ceramics from a sculptor. We are concerned that while it has been stated that programming will not change, that the quality of the art programming at Heights High will be deeply impacted by the loss of instructors who specialize in the field of study in which they teach. Our students know expressive arts are a tremendous benefit for them. For students who are strong academically, the expressive arts helps bridge the move from thinking to expression and from cognition to feeling. For students who are not strong academically, for students who feel lost in traditional curriculum and are at risk of failing, both academically and emotionally, the expressive arts are not just a benefit, but rather a necessity. Not all students feel like the college prep curriculum speaks to them. Please don't limit our children's access to the great benefits of the expressive arts. Come see for yourself. Come see our kids' work April 12th from 6 to 8 as we showcase Cleveland Heights, University Heights, kindergarten through 12th grade art show at the Lee Road Library. Thank you.
And on deck is David Mattia.
Good evening, board members, Ms. Dixon, and colleagues. My name is Patrick Brandon. I am a resident of Cleveland Heights. I've been a resident since 2012 and been married for 19 years. I have a daughter who goes to Roxborough Middle School, and I'm also one of the 15.5 special education teachers who got RIFT. And I work in the ED at Monticello Middle School. And to say, I've been in education for about 20 years, but working there has definitely opened my eyes to a lot of things, and I've dealt with behavior throughout those 20 years. But working with my students, and I have 9 kids in my classroom, 8 African-American males and 1 female, and the dynamics has been very challenging. But throughout it all, that's what I went to school for. That's what I feel my call and my passion. And the things that we have experienced throughout the year and have grown, the community, the continuity, the relationships that have been built, you know, we look at where we started and where we're at, and I gave my, you know, students a fourth quarter talk yesterday because it started the fourth quarter, and to get them motivated. And just a couple of weeks before, some of the students were making mention that, and I didn't even tell my students yet that I got, you know, RIFT, because I want to continue to build. I want to continue to grow. With those students. And, you know, as someone who has been faithful and married for a long time, also as a member of Alpha Phi Alpha fraternity, also as a minister, you know, I do understand the importance of continuity, brotherhood, relationships, and commitment. And being a resident, you know, when I graduated from Ursuline with my master's degree, you know, I wanted to work in a community where I live. I wanted to be a part of something special because I grew up in East Cleveland and I've always looked up to Cleveland Heights. But it didn't matter wherever I worked, it was always about the kids, whatever community I was in. And my colleagues, particularly at Monticello, have been very helpful and supportive as a first-year teacher in helping me through some of the trials and tribulations and the difficulties and the struggles, not only in the classroom, but outside the classroom. But the impact of leaving, and I'm concerned about my colleagues and how will that be taken care of? How will they be able to deliver academic services? But not only that, but also the relationships. Because all I hear from people is that ED is the hardest job in the district. And I don't know. I didn't know. I didn't care whether it was the hardest job in the district. I just know, and I knew that I had something to give. So with that being said, I'm going to close with this. Unlike LeBron James, who decided to take his talents elsewhere, a decision was made beyond my control that my gifts and talents are no longer needed in the CHUH school district. I will put my faith in God as to where they will land.
Just 1 second. On deck are three players from the Cleveland Heights University Heights softball team. I'm sorry, go ahead.
Hello, I'm David Mattia. I'm a 10th grader here at Heights High School, and I just wanted to give my opinion on the teachers' cuts. I may not be as well prepared as other people, but I'm speaking from my heart. Obviously, with the teachers' reductions, the class sizes are going to increase. This won't allow teachers to have a connection with their students. They'll be too rushed in the classroom. They won't be able to get enough done. They'll be focused on the students who need help rather than the other majority of the classroom. Being a ski instructor at Holiday Valley, I can recall this from personal experience. When I have kids, when I have 10, 13 kids all to myself trying to teach them how to ski, I know that I won't give as quality of a lesson than I will as if I have 2 to 3 kids. With 2 to 3 kids, I can teach them individually and while keeping the other kids busy. This year, the Heights Arts class classes are booked solid. All the freshman art classes are completely booked. The arts classes are the first ones to fill here at Heights because we have the best art teachers here. Many private schools kids transfer to Heights in the public school systems because we have better art facilities than they do. Ms. Gian, my studio teacher here, she has her Bachelor of Fine Arts in Painting and Drawing, and she knows how to teach this. She knows how to teach studio. By cutting the Heights Art Department in half, you're eliminating her position as well as my ceramic teacher here, Ms. Rack. And then you will require the photography teacher and the jewelry teacher to teach their positions. They're the ones who know how to teach them because they studied these positions all throughout their lives. You wouldn't require a history teacher to teach calculus, so why would you require a photography teacher to teach studio? Also, it doesn't make sense to get rid of the youngest teachers first. The youngest teachers are typically the least paid, so you would have to get rid of more younger teachers than if you have to get rid then you would have to get rid of teachers who've been teaching here 5, 6, 10 years. Also, the teachers who are 2 to 3 years into the school system, they know how to teach. They are recently coming out of grad school and college. They learn new ways to teach and more effective ways to teach. Also, they're usually more energetic towards us and give us more attention. I would like to end with this. By cutting the teachers, you cut the future of our students. Thank you.
On deck, I think is Jesse Gross. It's either Cross or Gross. I think it's Gross. If you would also just tell us your names.
Oh, yes. Thanks. Good evening. My name is Flannery Jewell. I'm a senior at Cleveland Heights High School, and I'm currently a varsity softball co-captain. The layoffs in our district will have detrimental effects on education for all ages, from elementary to high school students, and from the arts to the athletics. Our softball coach for the past 4 years is one of the 14 elementary school teachers who have been riffed. All of these teachers do their best so that their students will be successful in multiple facets. How can we expect some success some way when our youngest students are being deprived of the best education possible?
Hi guys, I'm Landry Sneed. I'm a senior in early college and I'm also a varsity co-captain. And usually I'm proud to represent Cleveland Heights. I want to wear my gear all day long, go out with it. But my shirt's inside out today because I'm just not proud to do that right now. This is about more than just money. This is our lives, it's our education, it's our future. We need these teachers to be there for us. I'm applying to college now, and I recently got my financial aid packet saying it's expensive, but it's a conscious investment. It's basically the same idea. I will gladly pay the price for a good education. These teachers... These teachers and these coaches, they invested in me, and I'm going to invest in them. I would not be a successful and bright student if it wasn't for them. There are so many other students who have the potential just to be like me, to be like David, Corinne, Aviva, all these people, all these students that are here right now. Who are we to take that opportunity away from them? I have Tavante from Amanda Delagrange's first grade class telling me he wants to be an engineer. What if we take away the teacher that's going to give him the care and attention he needs to keep loving math and science? So the last thing I have to say is don't undervalue us. Do not overlook us, and don't underestimate us.
And Dr. Donna Feldman is on deck.
Hi, I'm a student at Heights High School. I'm also very unprepared. I wrote this in my seat. I've lived in Cleveland Heights all my life. Due to the abundance of arts available to me, I feel attached to this area. I know that I belong. I feel very strongly about the limitations in the arts program, and this is this is a majorly arts-focused school, and some of the students come here specifically for arts programs. As you walk into the school, the first thing you see is student art. It welcomes and displays the importance of student achievement. If you are worried about the student enrollment numbers, one thing I suggest is to accentuate the arts, not deplete available arts classes. I have also been a part of special ed classes since the first grade. I feel the best part of my experience attending Heights schools have been the specialized classes. I've moved schools within the district in order to follow this program. The most successful year I've had was in a class of 11 students in an all-specialized class. Cutting these special ed classes intervenes and depletes the opportunity for specialized students to succinctly learn. Different students have different needs. To add, big classes eliminate the student-teacher downtime and limit students' ability to learn by creating a hectic environment made up of a diverse group of kids with different learning needs. Larger classes don't help students. It depletes students' success rate. Thank you.
On deck is David Jerns, and he wants to speak on the loss of drama. Go ahead, I'm sorry.
Good evening. My name is Dr. Donna Feldman. I hold a doctorate in urban education with a specialization in learning and development. I'm an English teacher and chief steward at the high school. I'm here tonight, like so many others of my colleagues, out of our concern for our students. Colleges cap class sizes. Tri-C, Cuyahoga Community College, caps at 24. My Lakeland Community College classes were capped at 15. Why would our class sizes exceed those of colleges in the area? Colleges know what parents and teachers know. Students learn better in small, personalized environments, but you don't have to take my word for that. A 2014 study by the National Education Policy Center found that smaller class sizes not only improve test scores, but they also improve later life outcomes, such as college completion. It also found class sizes, large class sizes, were more harmful to low-income and minority children. The proposed reduction greatly reduces art education, visual and drama. And at what savings? According to a recent study by the Brookings Institute, a teacher earning $55,000 a year costs $3,600 per student they educate. Now, these programs are being compromised, and they can be a draw to many families as they become disillusioned with private schools. I'm one of them who became disillusioned with private schools and put my own children in public school. I personally, in this district, have had students from various parochial schools as well as Beaumont and Hawken. We need these classes and smaller class sizes to attract and retain our students. I encourage you, I beg you to please vote to give our students the best education possible by rescinding the RIFs. Thank you.
Steve Burrows is on deck. Sorry.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is David Jerns. I do teach drama here at Heights High. I am a resident of Cleveland Heights. I have been for 7 years. And I've been teaching in the district for 4 years. And I say that because I want to emphasize that I moved here before I worked here. I grew up in Cleveland on the west side. And when my wife and I got married, hi, Beth. When my wife and I got married, we were looking for a place to start our lives and to start our family. And we found Cleveland Heights. And it's great. We love it here. A lot of what I was going to say has actually been said before, so I'll avoid those comments. But I do want to say that these RIFs eliminate drama. It's a program that we've been building here at the high school for the last 4 years. We have students that have graduated, that have gone on to major in theater. We're adding more classes, more students. We're adding courses in public speaking, and they're gone. They're evaporating as of next year. I think it's a great, great loss for our school, for our community. I could give you a lot of facts and figures about the power of drama education. We've heard a lot of facts and figures, so I won't go over those. Suffice to say that they are very real and very relevant, particularly to our low-income students. Again, I want to urge you to reconsider these RIFs. That's all I got. Thanks very much.
Zella Bros is on deck. Sorry.
My name is Steve Bros. I'm a physician. I have appointments at the medical schools of Case Western Reserve University and Ohio University, where I'm a clinical professor. And I serve veterans with spinal cord injuries at the VA hospital. I wish to speak to you today because why I feel the proposed plans to reduce the number of teachers and increase class size would be a tremendous error that would impact our community negatively for years to come. I'm accompanied today by my wife, Zayla, who is a first-generation American born in Hong Kong, and our two elementary-age children, Jason and John, both of which are receiving public educations in Cleveland Heights. Jason and John are currently receiving enrichment programs through Roxborough Elementary School at Cleveland Heights, and Jason is in a self-contained gifted class in Roxborough Elementary School. Now, I come from a family that was employed by a university, and although I could have gone to any private school, my family always felt that public schools provide an inclusion and a diversity that prepares students for a future, for future lives in a way that cannot be matched. true. Obtaining these benefits, however, requires the support of the community and a respect for the importance of maintaining small class sizes. My relationship with my teachers helped form my career direction, and the few classes that were forced to operate with a high student-to-teacher ratio were always the lowest value and impeded forming meaningful relationships with teachers. I still truly believe that the public education system has the potential to provide a superior education, and I'm grateful for the education I received. Now, I lived in Shaker Heights about 13 years ago, Shaker Heights, as a medical student, and before moving to Pittsburgh for my specialty training. When I returned to Cleveland to practice medicine, our family selected Cleveland Heights. We selected it over Solon, Beechwood, and Shaker Heights, largely due to the community atmosphere we observed in Cleveland Heights when we lived here before. We've long felt that Cleveland Heights is a community that's invested in its children's future. Now, Cleveland Heights currently provides the opportunity for my children to grow into whatever they want to be. Although we have the means to send our children anywhere for their education, both of my sons attend public school in Cleveland Heights. Because of superior and well-rounded education, we feel public schools have the opportunity to provide for the children. And my children already enthusiastically speak about their future careers. They're ambitious kids. You know, both my sons are high-achieving children with multiple interests, including sciences, music, drama, sports, theater, and literature. However, the ability of my children to achieve that superior education is threatened by the budgetary changes that are proposed. These changes would substantially increase class sizes, and which undercuts one of the single greatest strengths of our school system as it currently stands, a strength that could stand to reverse the trend of decreasing enrollment numbers over time associated with other changes. The size of a class is reflective of the personal time a student has with a teacher, and my high-achieving children and my two sons need personal attention for their teachers. It's particularly true of children with high aspirations. I'm not alone in this assessment. Numerous other professionals feel exactly as I do and will be forced to act if the proposed changes are adopted. I again implore us to reject the changes proposed. These ill-conceived changes would undercut the ability of our community to support our schools. Indeed, our family would not be the only one that would be forced to abandon our plan of having our children educated through the community's schools. Let me be perfectly clear. If these changes pass, my family would be forced to either take our support to a private school or leave the area entirely. And I can guarantee that if the current plan of undercutting support to our teachers and schools is pursued, my family's decision would not be the only one of this kind. Many other families would be forced to follow suit. This loss of enrollment would not be an isolated incident or trickle. Indeed, it would be a flood over time. Large numbers of parents who would otherwise be heavily invested in the betterment of the community and pushing their children to achieve their dreams through the public school system will instead be forced out of the community. This will further drive down enrollment numbers, and it will do so specifically in high-achieving children, which will again result in a small student-to-teacher ratio again, as we have now, but without the support of the community. This change will set a terrible precedent not only for Cleveland Heights, but for the community at large, and will not go unnoticed by the community. Thus, I again implore us not to pursue this course of action. Cutting support for teachers because enrollment is dropping will have the exact opposite effect of what is intended. The poor enrollment problems will accelerate, and community support for the schools will drastically fall. I'm not exaggerating when I say that I firmly believe that the future of our schools hangs in no small part upon this crucial decision.
Mr. Brose, I'm going to have to ask you something.
Please, make the only right decision.
Monica Deadweiler's on deck. I think we have Zayla Brose.
Hi, I'm a parent of Cleveland Heights Schools. I didn't know I got here late, but I just had a couple of things to say. I have a son that attends Roxborough. Thank you, Ms. Moss. And the things that's going on, I have a concern issue. Let me educate you real quick about who I am. My name is Joseph Hawthorne. I'm a resident of 22 years of Cleveland Heights. I have a son that's 14 years old, autistic. And go back to me, I'm a guy from public school, came out of high school, couldn't read or write, went to John Adams High School on the board of directors, Project Learn Adult Literacy. But I have several businesses in town, Beechwood, Cleveland Heights, North Randall. I have several car washes. I have raised over $100,000 in 2 days with my business for Cleveland Public School. I have an issue. My issue is, I don't understand the decisions that's being made. This is my first meeting. My first issue is about the buses. I have a special needs son. He loves riding the bus. I talked to Mr. Johnson. I don't know, but my issue is that he's on the bus with regular kids, and he's a special need kid. My son don't want to ride the bus no more. He came home with a busted nose, fights, altercations. I'm not saying my son is an angel, but I am questioning the ability of what's going on with the decision that's being made up here. Now I hear that it's a monitor on the bus. He's saying you don't have money. You want to cut kids, you want to cut the teachers. All of a sudden, we got somebody on the bus. I'm just saying, there's some things that's not being done right here. And as a resident with a lot of connections in this city, I am speaking up and I am calling Columbus. I need to know why this stuff is going on and why this is happening. You have Channel 8, Channel 19, Wayne Dawson, Boomer Esiason. I all asked them to stay back and let me come and speak. All I want to know is what is going to be going on in the future. My son is leaving. He's going to the high school. Right now, today, I will not let him go to the Heights. He loves drawing. If Mrs. Moss is here, she'll tell you. My son draws to everybody. He's already down at the school, down at the public arts, and he's working there. My son, with Mrs. Moss's help, he has taught himself how to read and write Japanese. Japanese. You understand me? And how we figured this out is that my place of business, a doctor from Cleveland Clinic walks in, and Jordan walks up and starts talking to him. And I say, Jordan, hey, quit messing with people. He runs off. The doc say, Joe, he was talking to me in my language. I said, really? I said, what did he say? He said, welcome to my dad's car wash. Hope you have a great time. And he walked off. Come to find out, every Wednesday, he goes to Hikes Library. He checks out books. Remember what I say. I'm the guy that gave LeBron James the throwback jerseys when he came out of high school. Everybody thought, oh, he wanted a picture. No, I gave it to him because LeBron had a 3.5. Again, these special needs teachers, you cutting back. I'm not knocking the regular kids, but these special needs teachers that you guys are cutting back, yeah, it's like oil and water. It's not going to work with you putting regular kids with special need kids. We found money to find the monitor. We could find money to save these teachers. I'm not here to start no hoo-ha. I'm a businessman, so I understand the economic, I understand the money part. But here it go. If I got a staff of 100 guys working for me, and my numbers start dropping, guess who got to take that cut? Me. All I'm asking, I've been here 22 years in Cleveland Heights. I could have put my kid in any school, Beechwood, Orange, on and on. I walked away because of my son is a special need. I walked away with $175,000 income to have him here in this town. So all I'm saying as a resident And as a parent, and as a concerned person for the future, guys, y'all got to get this together.
Thank you, Mr. Hoffman.
Thank you.
So, Zayla Brose is next, and then followed by Monica Deadweiler.
No, I'm Zayla Brose.
Yes, you're next. Yes, I'm sorry.
Hi, good evening, everyone. I'm here to say I wanted to give the point of view from a parent, from a resident in Cleveland Heights. Okay, I think school is like a people business. You can teacher and student, they have to build up the relationships, and this takes years. And if you just cut all the teachers now, then the whole pictures of the community actually changed. The first thing, when I moved into Cleveland Heights, the first thing I asked is what kind of school in this area? What kind of school is in this area? And then I think that people tell me that, Cleveland Heights have a lot of pretty good elementary school, but high school and middle school, you need to think about it. Then it's really sad. But then after a few years that I lived here, people said, people keep telling me that's a good things about the high school. They have the drama programs, they teach because the money that we can get, actually the kids actually get the education they can get, a high quality education. Then I heard something from my friends and said that it's a good school, yeah, but and especially you have option. If you can send your kids to the public school, you not only help your kids to grow up in an environment that can help them to meet a diversity of people, and then you help the community too. So it's not only the all these teachers is the investment, the whole community, we invest in them, instead invest in the teachers for several years now. If we cut them now, the last few years investigations actually just gone. And then the school kind of you can see a lot of people here because we have the concern. As residents, as a parent, we have a concern for this community. It's what happened to the school? Do they really want to increase the teacher studio as a teacher and student ratio? Is it do they really care about the students? I think a lot of people talk about this already. But in my point of view is if the repetitions of the Cleveland Heights is not as good as people, as good as other high school in other districts, people will move to other districts for a better reputation school. Just because of that. I heard a lot. Some of my friends already move into Shaker Heights or Orange or just because the repetitions of the school there is better than us. But I know that I know a lot of kids graduate from the high school here. They have bright future. They go to college in full ride scholarship. That thing happened. So please make the board member, please understand that if you cut all these teachers, it's not only just cut the teacher or cut these people, it's cutting the repetitions of the high school. And then that's another thing. If the high school here doesn't look good, because what we are the decision we are making right now, the real estate prices will drop. And then when that drop, the money go to our school system will even less. So please understand that it's not only your decisions here right now, it's not only affect the school system, it's affect the whole community. Thank you.
Um,
And Jan Ressiger is on deck.
Good evening. My name is Monica Detweiler. I'm a resident of Cleveland Heights. My family moved to Cleveland Heights in 1974. I am a boomeranger. I started off my life in Cleveland Heights, attended school in Northeast Ohio, went to Case Western Reserve as a graduate of Case Western, and then after that I went off to pursue my career in other cities. My family, we moved back here a few years ago from Chicago. And the reason why we moved back here was because of my longing for the childhood that I had in Cleveland Heights. And I wanted that childhood for my children. Many of my friends today are friends that I met while living in Cleveland Heights as a child. And I'm proud to say that I now have a ninth grader, Veronica, at Heights High School. And also I have a sixth grader. He's at a private school because of some developmental delays. But I must say though, we've been very pleased with my daughter's education here in Cleveland Heights High School and at Roxborough. And I implore you not to make these cuts that you are considering. I understand you're looking at the graphs, you're looking at the statistics, and you're thinking through saying, well, how can we be a good steward of the school district if we don't make these cuts? And you're looking at this, of course, from a financial standpoint. But I will tell you something, because I am an executive at one of the large organizations here in Northeast Ohio. And before returning back to Northeast Ohio, I was an executive at a Fortune 100 company that went bankrupt. But that company still exists today, because in the midst of cutting, they also invested. And they invested in the core. $24 billion company invested in the core in the darkest days. I implore you to invest in the core. The core are the students. And that core for the students comes directly from the teachers. And without those teachers, basically all you're doing is having a race to the bottom. And then at the end, like we used to say, at my old company, only the accountants and the lawyers would be left to shut off the lights. Keep your core, keep your students, and in order to keep your students, you have to keep quality teachers. I recall when we moved here, my children did not go directly into the public school system because we were products of Chicago at that time, where either you bribe somebody to get your kid into the best public schools, or you paid exorbitant tuition at private schools. And so that's what we did. We didn't do bribes, we just paid exorbitant tuition. And so when we moved here, we kept our children in private schools for a few years, and my daughter was in fifth grade, and we decided to make a change in schools. And my husband said, well, why don't we look at the public schools? And I remember saying, well, you know, I had a great time in public school, but I don't know. So my daughter did her day, her visit day at Hawkins. She did her visit day at Laurel, and she did her visit day at Roxborough Middle School. And I remember Principal McNichols spent time with me that morning, about an hour in his busy day, and walked me and toured me around the school. And this is after I've already seen Laurel and I had my tea and my cookies and did my little hippie thing over at Hawkins. And I'm looking in these classrooms and I'm seeing diversity, I'm seeing learning, and most importantly, I saw small class sizes. And at the end, And at the end of the day, my daughter came home and I asked her, how was school? I was expecting her to say, I hated it, I want to go to Laurel. No, she said, you know what, Ma, I like it. And so she's been in Cleveland High Schools ever since. And she's a great student. But I must say, like the gentleman, the doctor that stood up here before, when the cuts were announced, my daughter texted me and she said, I want to switch schools. Okay. And so right now, there's a possibility she may not be here next year because we do have a choice, but unfortunately many people don't. So invest in your schools, invest in your students, keep the teachers, and also one last thing because I know I'm over time. Other thing is, in Chicago, I watched a neighborhood we invested early in go from downtrodden, garbage real estate to now some of the most expensive real estate on the face of the earth. And basically everything happened out of the downtown core. And so then when those families then started to grow, they left the downtown core and they went to the inner ring suburbs. Cleveland Heights is an inner ring suburb. Invest in the future, keep your core. Don't let it go. Because although you're looking at linear algebra, you're seeing this, I guarantee you with the investments that the clinic is making, the downtown organizations are making,
you
are going to start to see a rebound in young, vibrant families buying in Cleveland Heights.
Thank you,
because they don't want to move to Avon, they don't want to drive for 2 hours, they want to live here.
Okay.
So invest. Thank you.
Joan Sproul's on deck. Jan, thank you.
My name's Jan Ressiger. I'm a senior citizen who became involved in our school district in 1988. My children graduated from Heights High School. I have some concerns about the term right-sizing to fix the so-called problem of too small classes. I think HB and US wouldn't define increasing class size as right-sizing. Is this a financial issue? Is it because we've lost so much money to Ed Choice vouchers and charters? Is it because of cuts in state funding? Is it to pose a levy campaign to bring back some teachers if we ever pass a levy? We are a school district with many students who are in the Cuyahoga County foster care system, many students living in poverty, many students with special education needs, and many, many students we've heard tonight who appreciate the privilege they have of going to a high school with such a rich curriculum and so many arts classes, drama, and my children benefited from the music program. I believe that these are all reasons why our district should seek to have the smallest classes we can possibly afford. Students are known to thrive at schools when they're known and understood by adults who have small enough class loads to really know their students. We need to be totally honest about what the issues really are. I think the community appreciates that. I also think that we're a district which has always sought to offer our students much more than the state minimum. Thank you.
On deck is University Heights Councilman Rock. Go ahead.
Hi, I'm Joan Spurl. I am a parent of a fifth grader at Roxborough Elementary School who also benefited greatly from the wonderful teachers he had at Fairfax Elementary. I'm also an early childhood educator, and I taught kindergarten for 10 years, and I had a class size of 25 that went down to 22. Just those three students fewer made a huge difference. And those were children who had been in that school from infancy and so had well-established relationships in the school. I taught Head Start and Steep Pre-Kindergarten in the Chicago Public Schools, and it was a challenge, and we did not have enough adults for the number of children we had, and we couldn't do as well by them. Dr. Dixon, you knew this job wasn't going to be easy. You've already made a lot of positive changes here, and I have still great hope that more can come. But what do we say to children? We say knowledge is power. Challenges are how we grow. You can't learn without being challenged, really, right? You learn better if you have the right amount of challenge. So I'm hoping tonight is the right amount of challenge. When you make a mistake, we tell children when you make a mistake, it's okay. That's how you learn. I'm thinking you've learned a lot of really great things about your teaching community and your community tonight. You've learned the incredible devotion of our teachers and the passion of our students and our parents. Tonight's got to be rough, but you commend it. You're a really good listener. I know you've listened to children and you've made changes, positive changes, based on what you've heard from them. I've actually, just 3 weeks ago, saw you in the office at Roxborough Elementary. You went on your own time before the school day began because a student wanted to talk to you about something, and you were there and you were hearing what she had to say. That's great. Keep listening and learning. Listen. Tonight. I know you've been listening tonight, so please learn from everything people have been saying. I agree with so much of what's been said, and I know you have the best of intentions for our community. But listen and learn. And just so you know, Cal, there's two students down here who didn't get to sign up but who want us to talk later. Thank you so much.
Okay. And Melissa Wood is on deck. Councilman Rock. But I'll let you, we'll have you come at the end if you don't mind. It's just a few more. Sorry. Is Councilman Rock here? Oh, sorry about that. It's hard to see.
It's hard to hear back there. I have everything on my phone. I'm trying to keep paperless for our council. So my name is Councilman John Rock. I am a councilman for the city of University Heights. And thank you for having us here today. I'm not here to speak in support or opposition to the cuts, but I want to give you a different perspective. I'm an architect, and I build schools, I design universities, because as an architect, we know that strong schools build strong communities. And I love the passion here today about the arts, because I can really appreciate that. It makes me happy. That's exactly what I do, so. Look, this is a really tough decision. I know what it's like to balance a budget. I'm now on council. We have to go through these decisions every day. I get it. You have to balance a budget. That is very tough. However, speaking as a city councilman today, I want to let you know about the huge challenge it is to retain and recruit new families into the community. When there's a perception that their school district is cutting back, when there's a perception that they're losing value or losing services, it's already a challenge to retain and recruit new families into our community when we're already, as Cleveland Heights and University Heights, paying the highest tax rates in the region. It's already tough. So I'll be brief so I can yield my time to the rest of the community here, but I hope you take these factors into consideration, that there is a practical difficulty between our two cities. I just want you to consider that. So thank you.
Melissa Wood is next. Ryan Routh or Ruth is on deck. To the students who are there, there's like two more after that, just so you know.
Couldn't hear. Hello. My name is Melissa Wood. I am a resident, a graduate of Coventry, Roxborough, and Heights High. I have a daughter in the ninth grade here at Heights and one in third grade at Roxborough Elementary School. But that's not really, I'm not really here to talk to you about in my capacity as a parent. I'm also a substitute teacher. Hopefully one day a real teacher, but I'm a substitute teacher. Thank you. I spend most of my time here at the high school.
And I want to talk to you about the special ed program. Because before I started subbing, I really didn't know what an intervention specialist did. But I got into, I met some teachers, and I seemed to spend most of my time subbing in intervention, in special ed classes for intervention specialists. And I am extremely concerned about this average, this class size change, and the possibility of this 1-16 ratio that supposedly is under the state guidelines, but still much higher than what we have. And I just like to tell you about classes that I see called individual instruction classes. There, you know, we have. I don't know if you guys have actually, all of you have actually been in the classes and seen these classes, you know. But a lot of these kids in the special ed program, I mean, they're mainstreamed, which is great for most of the day, and they get a period a day, or at least I'm not an expert about how it all works, but I see them in these small classes where they get to this one-on-one experience with a teacher who knows them, who knows their issues, who knows their classes, who knows their course load, who helps them navigate through this sometimes, you know, a cacophony of classes and hallways, and for kids who need to leave early for class because they can't quite manage the stress in the hallway. They get the support from that teacher. That teacher knows them. In a class that's bigger, I mean, I can't imagine a class bigger than 10. You know, I've seen classes like of 4 that I think are perfect, you know? And when I send my daughter here, and she's not in these classes, but when I send her here and I, you know, I'm worried about her, and I'm worried about her art classes, and I'm worried about her bigger classes for her, but I'm also worried about the climate of the school that she's in. And I think that these small classes for 19 to 20% of our population are imperative to maintaining the kind of atmosphere and the respect and the kindness and the feeling of safety and security that our kids need in the schools. Kids, you have to give kids who need it the space they need. And I think that you haven't taken into account enough who our population is. You know. So that's what I'm asking, is please, at the very least, come and take a look at some of these classes, some of these special ed classes, and that with these teachers that you're laying off, and see how they function and see their importance. Thanks.
So Ryan Routh or Ruth is next, and Laura Bear or Burr is next. I apologize for any misnamings.
Hello, my name is Ryan Ruth.
I got one of them.
Appreciate that. I'm a Cleveland Heights resident for 17 years, and my wife is a lifelong resident. I have a daughter at Heights on Ms. Dixon's student cadre. I'm not an expert on reductions. I'm a bit of an outsider. My daughter goes here, but I don't pretend to know as much as you know or as much as some of the folks in the teachers union know. I don't believe you're the enemy on the board. I appreciate you standing up here and listening to all of us tonight. I doubt any of you ran for school board because you're excited to implement RIFs. On the other hand, when I hear people like Ari Klein and Brian Shaner say, start raising red flags, both of them teach my daughter, and I know they're smart, reasonable people. And so it seems to me that smart, reasonable people should be able to reach more of a meeting of the minds than I feel like I'm seeing here. And so I hope you do work with them closely, and I hope their concerns are taken seriously. But as an outsider, we kind of have to trust the experts on both sides to get it right, and I hope you can get to that point. Because I'm not an expert on RIFs, you know, maybe like the University Heights councilman, I don't necessarily have a position on that. I do want to touch on three related issues. The first is transparency. I hope you keep transparency at the front of your minds through this process. I was very heartened when, I think the RIFs were announced on a Thursday or Friday, and there was a relatively detailed memo on the website, I believe the following Monday. For people like me who, maybe aren't as involved, it's so heartening to see a school board that's trying to be open. Hopefully that was something you did on your own and not because of complaints. But I really hope when it comes to rehires, when it comes to admin cuts, that you're drowning us in information because it is appreciated. People are looking at it. First point, transparency. Second point, the timing of the admin cuts versus the teacher cuts. There very well may be a good reason for it. Maybe I'll hear the reason after I sit down. It seems weird to an outsider that we're hearing teacher cuts tonight and that's being approved and the admin cuts are being approved separately. It seems to me it's hard to evaluate the overall reasonableness of cuts that are at least in part designed to address financial issues unless we have that kind of the whole package. So if there's a way to delay, that would seem at least like to be something that you should consider. If that's not possible, then maybe I'll understand why. The third thing is in some ways the elephant in the room that I didn't hear much about. And I think that we should all remember that we're here at least in part because the levy didn't pass. I hope everybody that's clapped tonight voted for the levy last time it was up. I hope that when the next levy comes around, that everybody in this audience votes for the levy, and I hope they call at least 10 friends and get them to vote for the levy. And I think maybe we'll find ourselves on the same side of future meetings like this. Thank you.
Laura, again, Burr or Bear is next, and then followed by, I think it says Jackson Henninger. If I get that wrong, I apologize. And then students, you're after that. Is Laura Burr or Bear here? It's hard for me to see, so if someone's moving, like wave or something. All right, well, I'm going to skip her then. Jackson Henninger or Henninger? It's Henninger? Henning? Is Jackson here?
He would probably be with Laura.
Okay, he'd probably be with Laura. Okay, so the students who are waiting, come on up, but please tell us your name. Names, I guess I should say.
Hello. My name is Taylor Sims. I am a 12th grader at Cleveland Heights High. I have been here most of my life since kindergarten, and I don't have a problem, but I have a brother who's actually at Roxborough who's about to graduate and come to the high school, and my parents are mortified that he actually has to come here. You guys already have us stuck in this school, and I'm sorry, this little compact school. There's a period in the day where we're actually walking in the hallways and there's so many people that we can't get past each other. We're piled on top of each other. Fights happen almost every day. It's been 70 something fights, almost 80 fights this whole school year. And, Heights has been this beautiful school with all these different opportunities. I mean, even people from Shaw and Collinwood, would praise me for going to Heights and having all these different opportunities and stuff. And I can't even tell them come to Heights or whatever, and tell them how good it. What? Oh, my bad. Sorry. And tell them how good it is because you're cutting all these programs, and it's not even the same anymore. I didn't expect to spend my 12th grade year stuck. It's we're crabs in a barrel, and we're trying to get out. I don't know. I can't really explain it. You can talk. They're just mortified, and I always wanted my brother to get the public school experience. I had a good experience, and we're basically looking at St. Ed's and St. Ignatius now for schools for him, and we don't want that. We live here. Why would we have to pay for a better education somewhere else farther away from here? There's a free public school up the street, and we can't even get that, so.
Hi, I'm Melissa Hall, and I'm also a senior here. I want to say, at first, I did not start off in Cleveland Heights. I was at Shaw, like she just said. And when I pretty much moved here, and I would say November of my freshman year, I felt lost. I knew no one at all, like literally no one. I had no friends, I was drowning. I got into the early college program and just like failed completely. So when I came here, when I came back my 10th grade year, it was a new teacher named Miss Brown. Miss Brown, I don't know if you're out there, but her, Miss Lambright, Miss Stanky, Mr. Neitzel, and what all the other early college teachers, they really pushed me. At that point in time, in the 9th grade year, I did not have enough credits to graduate. But because of them, they pushed me, and I have more than enough credits to graduate. They became my family. Ms. Brown, every single day, Alyssa, come on, you can do it, you can do it. Even though I felt like an outsider, they brought me in as a family. And I don't think it's right that you would ripple, or whatever you guys call it, Ms. Brown, because she made an impact. I also want to point out a second person that made an impact. Coach Stewart. Coming from sports in East Cleveland was not a very transition, like a good transition. I'm pretty sure you guys know about the rivalry. But he also pushed me to the best I can do. Also, because of Coach Stewart, I have a best friend of 4 years. I have a team that I call my family because of Coach Stewart. Still to this day, I still look at Coach Stewart as the track dad. Basically, the whole point of me telling this story is I'm pretty sure that every student in Cleveland Heights High School, every student has a teacher that has impacted them to make them successful, to say, oh, I can do it. I'm pretty sure it's every student in here can say a teacher impacted them. So I just feel like you should keep them because, well, it's obvious. Thank you.
I'm sorry, this is unorthodox, but as students in the Heights system, I was wondering if it would be possible that we could make a brief statement.
Sure, we'll allow it.
Okay. So, this round of cuts was initially advertised as a budget issue. This makes it seem as if you are trying to run the district as a business. When the administration has money problems, the workers, or in this case the teachers, take the hit. This is unacceptable. The arts program is a significant part of the CHUH schools, and the teachers that teach in these programs go through years of specialized schooling to become extremely proficient at what they do. When I first entered the arts program at Heights, what struck me most was the true compassion of the teachers, the willingness to do extra work to help the students succeed, something that I considered unique. The connection of students and teachers is something that is built up over time, and it is irreplaceable. You are dealing with the futures of real-life students, and initially this seemed like a faceless decision with no consideration for the welfare of the student learning process. I'm here as a student to try and compel you to reconsider this decision that will not only affect students that are at the school now, but students that are up and coming in our system whose chance to have a bright future should not be compromised.
Hello, my name is Mary Jane Reinhart. I am a 10th grader at Cleveland Heights High School. I have never been a student who enjoys school. In fact, I can say that times I have honestly rather despised it. As a student who has trouble focusing and motivating, I often had no interest in what was being taught in my classes. But upon starting high school, I experienced something entirely new. So many Heights High teachers are so dedicated to their students, so focused on making sure they teach meaningful and educational courses. Teachers here are willing to sacrifice their free time so that students can use their rooms to further their creativity and education. This is, however, so incredibly dependent on student-teacher relationships. These student-teacher relationships are so vital to so many students. Students, or at least students like myself, learn best when they form these meaningful relationships with their teachers and participate in their classes. And when those class sizes grow too large, this simply does not happen. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you all. Oh, is there someone else? Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. Sorry, I couldn't see you. I apologize.
Hi, my name is Glennis Koval, and I am a ninth grade student, and I am taking Chinese as a foreign language. You are riffing our only Chinese teacher at our high school, and while there may not be a huge enrollment in the Chinese class, the students who are taking it find it a very important and a big impact on their learning. So cutting the only Chinese teacher is having a deep impact on the students who are trying to pursue learning Chinese.
Thank you. Okay. Is there one more? Oh, there's one. Okay, I'm sorry.
I'm Sylvia Snorakli. I'm in eighth grade. And I just wanted to say, these teachers that are providing so much nourishment and care also provide after-school programs and clubs. And these are safe. These clubs provide kids with a safe, nourishing environment. And when we fail to provide these kids with this, what will happen to the students?
Would it be all right if I made a short statement?
All right, yeah, and I think after this we'll call.
There's nobody behind me.
Okay, we'll call it quits after this. You get to wrap up the evening. Thank you, go ahead.
My name is Dr. Daniel Palmer. I'm a professor at John Carroll University, and I just wanted to provide, first of all, I agree with most of what's been said tonight, but I wanted to provide a slightly different take on what I'm seeing. I have some of your early college students in my classes, and they are well-prepared, excellent students to have there. What impresses me even more, and not just about the early college students, but in general, is how mature so many of the students here are. I recently was a parental chaperone on the music trip to Nashville, and every place we went, from the buffet dinners, to the hotels, to the places we stayed at, people went out of their way to comment to us how amazing our students were. In addition, these same people told us that they had other schools there recently, and it was a disaster. And I would like to say that in my estimation and in my observation, it's having amazing role models that provide this for them. And that goes for every teacher out there, and in my personal experience, some of the ones who have been riffed. So I urge you to reconsider. Thank you.
So first, I want to thank everyone for coming tonight. I want to thank everyone who chose to speak. That's exactly what you need to do when you have something an important issue. We absolutely recognize not only the importance of the issue, the difficulty of the issue. I will tell you that hearing some of the testimonials that we heard, regardless of how this evening goes, right, it's just amazing to hear it. Thank you, Dr. Palmer. Thank you, all the students. Thank you, the teachers who all stood up. I'm going to change things around a little bit tonight, just because I feel it makes sense for us at this point to at least have Dr. Dixon make some sort of statement. So I'm going a little bit off agenda. I hope no one minds, but Dr. Dixon, I'll give you a chance here.
All right. Good evening, everyone. And I echo the sentiments that Cal stated. As the leader of this organization, as Joan Spurl spoke, I'm challenged to make tough decisions at times. Some of these decisions may not be popular, but I believe they're decisions that are best for the organization. When I was chosen as the superintendent of this community, I applied to this community because of the differences that were here, the people, the potential. And I moved to this community as well. It's been tough knowing that when I came in this district, there was no strategic plan. So I said, wow, how are we going to know what direction to go in without a plan? So the first year, I asked the community, Cleveland Heights and University Heights and students, to come together, let's put together a 5-year strategic plan. So that one, we would increase our graduation rates. We saw only 82% of our high school students were graduating from high school. 82%. And to me and others, that was not acceptable. I've not asked the union to make any decision regarding this plan based on any dollar amount. We've had discussions in October, and I simply stated to them, we need to look at the organization and to be able to sustain this organization. I want to see the organization to continue to thrive. Thrive for the community, thrive for the students. I've never asked my staff or the union staff, given them a dollar amount and said we need to cut X amount of teachers to save a potential dollar amount. I've never asked that of any union person or of my staff. I said to them, let's look at our organization, the number of staff members that we have working for this organization, and can we maintain that staff with the number of students that we're losing? I even asked for an updated enrollment projection. We have updated enrollment projection that was given last fall, November of 2015. We've had ongoing conversations since October regarding what directions we should move in, what classes had low enrollment, what programs that we need to look at that we need to increase our enrollments. We know that we have a low amount of students in our high school that were taking advanced placement courses. So I reached out with MSAN and asked for a grant to allow our teachers in our high school to look at what are some of the ways that we can get more of our students to take advanced placement courses in our high school, because we know that they have the potential. The results from that, we have 300 students who could potentially could take advanced courses next year in our high school. And I think that's great. We need that. The students have the potential to do it. Let's make that happen for them. The community also stated that we needed to invest in pre-K. We're opening a pre-K unit at Oxford Elementary next year. So we are investing. As we make some potential cuts, we have to make investments as well. And there will also be additional pre-K units that will be open at our other elementary schools as we move forward, because we have to continue to invest in our future. I also heard that we are harming our children. We cannot harm our students. And I don't want us to harm our students. Yes, our students make connections with our teachers. We know that. We know that our teachers are going to continue to make those connections with our other students. We want that to happen, and we know that that will continue to happen. We have an expert staff. We know that. We've invested a lot of money in our staff, the training. Yes, we have. Yes, it's going to benefit if our teachers leave and go to other districts. Yes, districts are going to benefit because districts know that Cleveland Heights does a great job with educating our staff and giving our staff training. I know that, and yes, that is that will be a huge loss to our organization. I realize that. We have worked tirelessly to create a plan that I believe will be best for the organization, and we've not done that in isolation. We've had ongoing conversations with the many people and administrative staff and our union. We've not made these decisions in isolation. We've not. And I know they're tough, but we're going to get through it. We're going to make sure that our students continue to have good teachers in front of them, teachers who care like all of you and our other teachers in our organization. That will continue. We will continue to invest in early education. Our class sizes will grow in many cases to 19 to 21. And that is so there's a myth that our classes are going to go up to 30. I'm not sure where that came from. And some of our elective classes will continue to be at 30 phys ed. Some of our elective classes will have higher numbers. But many of our classes will be under a 30 threshold. Our student-teacher ratios will continue to remain low. So it is a tough decision, I know, for many of you. It is a tough decision for us as well. And as Ari stated, he did ask that we consider this cut over time. He did. And I stated, let's do the cuts this year, Ari. Let's do the cuts this year, and let's continue to move forward. So that's my comment. We will continue. To the teachers who are affected by this cut, it's 52 teachers. There are not all classroom teachers. I will say that 6 teachers affected by, impacted by this, is because of a potential reduction at Belfair. We currently have 6 teachers that work at Belfair, and Belfair will potentially close, possibly, at the end of this year, and go to become a private organization. And if so, 6 staff members will be affected. If that does not happen, then 6 teachers will remain at Belfair, and that number will go from 52 to 46. But we would know that by the end of this month if that will happen with Belfair. Also, the administrative cuts. We have 5 administrators that will be cut as well. So that is coming forth to the board in May. The reason I did those separately because there was not a budget impact. I did not tell the board that I need to bring some cuts, $3.5 million to the board. That was never stated. But I wanted to do the cuts with the teachers first to give the teachers the opportunity to find employment and us help with those teachers to find employment. So I wanted to do it earlier. And then administrators, we're doing some reorganization within our administrative ranks, but 5 positions in administrative ranks will be eliminated as well. Special ed programming, we've spoke to those teachers that are impacted by the special ed cuts. Our special ed staffing caseloads, as some has spoke about, will increase, but those would be those cross-categorical classes only. We understand it. I understand that those are students, and those are students with more need, and those students that will still receive the expertise from those teachers who will be continue to teach those students. That's what we have to, yes, we will continue to provide training for those teachers that may need additional training. But in order for us,
I'm going to ask people to try their best to let Dr. Dixon speak. Let's let her have her piece, just like we had it. Let everyone speak up here, okay?
I've always stated the truth. I have never not been transparent to this organization since I've been in this seat. I have always been open and transparent. Anytime anybody has asked me a question, I've been open and transparent. So if anyone says that I haven't been, I'll challenge you on that. I've been open and transparent. So as we move forward, I hope that everyone understands that I believe that this is the right decision for the organization. And we're going to move forward in providing the best education for our students in Cleveland Heights, University Heights community. And I thank those teachers who've been here, who've been with us, who've been working and making connections with our students. I applaud your efforts, and we will continue to support you during this time of transition.
Do any board members have anything they'd like to say at this time?
Well, I mean, I think we've got a lot of questions and stuff. Are you moving the agenda so we're going to be voting on this now, or what was your thought?
Yeah, I think it's worth us changing around the agenda. So I will put the personnel section up now in front of the superintendent's report. But so I'll tell you what, so that we do this in the right order, let's just do, I can take items personnel 1 through 5 ahead. Mm-hmm. Is that right? So we're just going to give us a second. So I need a motion for items D 1 through 5.
So moved. Second.
Any questions, comments?
So these are items, just so everybody understands, that have nothing
not
to do with the
about
RIFs.
The RIFs yet. Yeah,
it's like retirements, which bring down that number of 52, by the way, to a lower number, but okay.
Right. So, Mr. Ginn?
Mr. Register?
Yes.
Mr. Silverman?
Yes.
Ms. Wright?
Yes.
Mr. Zucker?
Yes.
Mr. Posh?
Yes.
Okay. Item, I can take the next two separately? Or together?
You can take.
Okay, so the next two items are the approval of the elimination of positions due to reduction in force and the approval of suspension of contract due to reduction in force. I need a motion.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, now we can have discussion and questions. Mr. Posh, you seem to have one, so go ahead.
I have a whole lot, but I mean, I think in the spirit of transparency, I think it's important to understand that Dr. Dixon did present the board information to document her decision on why she wanted to do this. It's lengthy, it's very, very compelling. It goes against a lot of the misnomer that you hear in the community. There was an executive session, again, in the spirit of transparency, to talk about personnel issues, which is totally in the sunshine laws. At that point, we were talking about your talk about the administrators. One of them mentioned, I mean, again, just being totally transparent, I was not comfortable personally making any kind of decisions regarding the teachers without knowing the same level of effort was spent with this administration in cutting a similar proportional number of administrators.
Right. Correct.
Okay.
That's
I'm talking and I'm going to put words in your mouth. I mean,
that's correct.
But I mean, the percentage of administrators that are being cut by headcount is higher than it's essentially the same, as the teacher cuts are.
Correct.
And by contract laws, mm-hmm. or the contract that you have with the union, you have to let the union know before the administrators? Is that?
No, we don't have to. I just decided to do it that way.
Okay.
Yeah.
And part of the rationale, and even in a letter I saw from Union President Mr. Klein, it was, you know, partly to, you wanted to give the teachers as much notice as possible.
Correct.
So that they'd be able to find employment. But technically, if we waited to the last minute, what date would we would have to okay this by Ohio law in the contract?
6 was Paul Lombardo. In May, that's what the first meeting in May or the second meeting in May, but in May.
So essentially, you've given the teachers an extra 30 days to find other employment.
Correct.
Okay. The class size that, I mean, I've seen comments that substantially increasing class size. Can you address the fact that we are not substantially increasing class size?
Right. And I think that's depending on what people believe is a substantial amount. You know, we have enjoyed low class sizes. Some of our class sizes, in some of our special ed classrooms, we have 8 and 9 students. Yes, we do. Not to say it was bad. I'm just giving the facts. So we have low class sizes.
You know, hold on a minute. You know, we gave this audience a lot of respect listening to them. I mean, are you guys listening to us or are you like talking back? I mean, this is an important decision. We've got 52 teachers that are losing their jobs. And I think we're trying to take this pretty seriously, okay?
Thank you. So some of our classes are increasing from 14 to 16 students. Some are going from 14 to 15 to 19 students to 21 students.
Are we losing any programming, such as art classes?
No, we're not losing programming. However, some of our art teachers, as someone stated, high school or secondary classes, those teachers have various certifications. So yes, if you hold a certification for art 912, for example, you may not have a specialized art degree, as some of our teachers do have in our high schools, but you're still eligible you still have the credentials, rather, to teach that art class.
So for example, and this is the way it was sort of explained to me, it's a leading question, I suppose, that there's sort of a schedule on how teachers are essentially let go based on seniority and state licensure. So if there was the need for I don't want to use a real example, but an art teacher that had a certain level of certification, if that person was at a certain level, they're first to go. And if you have an art teacher someplace else, let's say at Belfair, for example, they fill in because they have the seniority. Is that correct?
Right. See, a Belfair, if Belfair, if we move forward with the Belfair decision, six teachers will be impacted. If we do not move forward with Belfair, then six teachers will not, that number will go from, and Ari knows as well, from 52 to 46. So it will not, additional art teacher will stay, additional guidance counselor will stay, three interventionist specialists will stay, a monitor will stay as well.
And the private organization that runs Belfair contracts our teachers.
Correct.
And they're looking for another alternative.
Yes.
Besides our teachers. So, correct. And they've given you notice that they want to change, but you're waiting.
Right, they've given notice that they want to change, and we've stated to them that we must have a commitment by the end of this month. If not, then we're not moving forward with that decision.
But you can't.
We can't.
Because
we don't want to wait any longer. Okay. And then that means six teachers will keep their jobs. And we, three interventionists, one art teacher, one guidance counselor, and one monitor.
I have other comments, but I don't want to hog the floor.
Go ahead.
I've got other comments. Mine are more closing. You go.
Well, go ahead. I mean,
I've been talking.
You go and.
Well, no. The one thing I will say, I appreciate you mentioning the administrative staff reduction as well, because I know there's this perception, probably much broader in the community, perhaps from an adversarial nature of admin versus teachers and vice versa, that we're, it's just teachers, but we're looking at a over 10% reduction in admin as well. Mm-hmm. So I think that goes to the issue that of how your plans and methodologies for reallocation of resources. I know personally two of the folks who are being riffed. I like them. This sucks. I don't like it. I know how it feels. I was laid off four times in 12 years. It sucks. I'm not going to make any bones about that. I will say the board's responsibility is to hire a superintendent and a treasurer and empower them to run the district. We have to make business-like decisions because that's what we have to do. I mean, I don't mean to deny the emotional statements, and I think the professor from John Carroll at the end is that validation of the students who we saw this evening and the product of the work of our staff. But this is, we empower the superintendent, and I've been very, very, I sometimes disagree with the superintendent, but I've been very, very happy with her pressing her staff at Miramar and pressing staff district-wide to challenging them perhaps in a way that our superintendents in the past haven't. I've been here 2 years, but I can still, I feel that this is positive. I think I don't like this. I don't like it, but if this is the course of action that our superintendent feels is the best course of action, I have to support it. And all weekend I was going through data. I think that I would encourage, I don't know where Scott Wortman is, I can't see the lights in here, but I do feel that we need to, there's a high degree of, I don't want to say misinformation, but a game of telephone. And I think the more that we can get out there as far as clarification as to what exactly is the impacts of this will be, the more we can have. I know Jim's very big on transparency. The more that we can get out there in regard to the specifics of these impacts and the rationales behind it on the website and scat through the media, the better for us, because we have an echo chamber in this community in regard to information. So the more that we can clarify that and explain why this is, the better. And the key thing I think we need to keep in mind too is from a time, as we saw this evening, we had a few retirements, we have this Belfair issue in play. I think we need to emphasize that 52 positions is a worst case scenario. And as time progresses, my hope is that as many as possible of those who are RIFed will not be RIFed. And like I said, I know two individuals on that list personally. One of them is an alum. I believe he lives in the system as well. I don't want to lose him. I know he's going to get scooped up. I don't want to lose him, though.
Right.
But it's...
Right. So. Jim, you have more?
Well, yeah. I mean, I think there's a couple things that need to be addressed. And, you know, one of the students said, you know, you're not a corporation. And it's, you know, we're not. I mean, typically when... big corporations RIF staff, it's so shareholders are enriched and CEOs make more money. That's not the case here, okay? We failed a school levy, and I'm looking at this from a different lens than Dr. Dixon, okay? Dr. Dixon is looking at this from an efficiency perspective, best practices perspective. You know, I'm really looking at this from, I think, more of a community perspective. One of the biggest things that, most of you know I ran for school board just recently. I'm new to all this, really trying to get up to speed as quickly as possible. There's a lot of information here. Mm-hmm. But one of the biggest things that resonated when I talked to people when I ran was the ability to be fiscally sustainable. Mm-hmm. You know, we have to put school levies on the ballot every 3 to 4 years. Okay, we're on the fifth year right now. We lost our last school levy. It's pretty inevitable that we have to make some cuts. The big difference here right now is there's a disagreement between the level and number of cuts that Dr. Dixon wants to make versus the number of cuts that the union feels is palatable.
Right.
Yeah, I'd be first to say, I mean, if money was no object, we should be hiring people. We want small class sizes. That it's not sustainable, guys. I mean, how much money are we losing to Ed Choice every year, approximately? I mean, I'm putting you on the spot. Maybe I shouldn't do that.
No,
it's like, you know, within
Ed
a million
Choice
or two.
And all the others, about $6 million.
About $6 million, okay? So this is money to fund Ed Choice, which is basically kids in our district that go on to private schools. And charter schools. And that number is increasing. I mean, we are under attack financially. If we don't pass a school levy real soon, we need to talk about when we're going to get that on the ballot. There's going to be even more cuts than this. I mean, because we just can't be fiscally sustainable. So the issue here is, I mean, what is this magic number? Is it 30? I mean, what's going to make people happy? I mean, frankly, zero, I think, is the only number, and I don't see how that's fiscally responsible. So I guess this is what I would ask the district. I mean, it's pretty inevitable that there's going to be a vote about this, and I mean, just sort of getting the sense, I mean, I'm pretty sure that it's, I mean, these RIFs are going to go through. We don't know if the number is 52 because of attrition, because of Belfair. I am hopeful that we can hire back as quickly as possible those teachers that are affected by this. I mean, once you get a solid number. I am hopeful that if there's any cut in any program, we find out about it ASAP so we can make a decision to increase the budget to hire back more teachers, because I really don't want to see any changes to programs. You're in the process of compiling additional class size information. You shared some of that information with us tonight. We are still with a pupil to classroom teacher ratio really, really low, even with these cuts compared to neighboring districts. And I know you compute that differently with special ed versus non-special ed. I mean, it's mind-boggling. I would like to see a complete list of that and kind of see how that sort of shakes out as this sort of goes through. Oh God, there's one other thing I was going to say. Does anybody have anything else to say before I remember what that is? The timing of the cuts, I guess we already addressed that. Oh, okay, so, I mean, I guess I wanted to close on the fact that, you know, we do pay pretty much the highest property taxes in the region. We have to be sensitive to that. So when we put a levy on the ballot, I mean, it's gotta be the lowest amount as possible, and I know this reduction in force and is gonna help that a little bit, so.
Good. Nothing else from them? Okay, I have just a couple things. First, Dr. Dixon, I just need to ask you directly one more time for your reassurance that if we go forward with this, that this does not compromise the integrity of the program, and I mean at all levels, academics, arts, music, career tech, all the different levels.
No, it does not. Our class sizes will be higher, but we'll still have the same offerings for our students in our schools.
Okay, all right. I'm gonna make a few brief comments before we vote, and I apologize for being so direct. I think it's very important that I explicitly state the impact of the vote that we're about to take. The decision that we're gonna make, if we accept the administration's recommendation, means people will lose their jobs. And I'm not trying to be dramatic, and I'm not trying to tell you anything you don't already know, but I think it's critical that that fact is in the forefront of our minds as we vote. One of our jobs is, maybe it was Eric who said, maybe it was Jim, I don't know, but one of the jobs of the board member is to determine whether or not to support the recommendations brought to us by the administration. We do this using the data presented to us, we do this using our sensibilities about the district, we do this by using the sensibilities about the community in general. In my opinion, Dr. Dixon has described a thoughtful, inclusive decision process. She included administrators, she included building principals, she included union leadership in an iterative process. She has recommended a bold path, and yeah, it's a difficult path. It's a very difficult path for aligning the resources of our district, and she has aligned this with the district strategic plan. She has assured us that we shall maintain the integrity of the program. And we have to couple all of this, as Jim was just saying at the end, with our obligation to the community to deliver our programming in as efficient as a manner as possible. This is a terrible, terrible thing that we have to do, but it's something we have to do. The decision I make tonight gives me no happiness, but I believe it is necessary for the long-term health of our district. Our obligation does not end with today's students. We need to look to the future as well. Mr. Gaynor will take the roll.
I did remember the last thing I was going to say, and it's kind of sad that all the union leadership just left, but okay. Ari sort of put this letter in front of us. No time to digest it, but I would like to digest it, and he has claimed that some errors were made. I mean, if we have in fact made errors, I hope that we can reverse some of these decisions. But I mean, I think we all need some time to digest that information.
Okay, Mr. Gaynor.
Mr. Silverman.
Yes.
Ms. Wright.
Yes.
Mr. Zucker.
Yes.
Mr. Posh.
Yes.
Mr. Register.
Yes.
Okay. I need a motion for item D8.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion?
Very much, sure.
Okay, Mr. Gaynor?
Ms. Wright?
Yes.
Mr. Zucker?
Yes.
Mr. Posh?
Yes.
Mr. Register?
Yes.
Mr. Silverman?
Yes.
So now we'll go back to the superintendent's report.
We have item one, the final approval of our school calendars for the 2016-17 school year and 17-18 school year.
Okay, I need a motion, please.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion, questions? Yes,
I have questions.
Mr. Silverman.
I don't know who to, who's, where our staff is. That
Paul and Barter. Paul, if you could come up, please.
You need to come up to the mic.
Paul, you should have known I was going to ask questions about this.
Yes, go ahead.
Okay, my question is this. Now, is it my imagination, or I noticed January 13th, February 10th, these records days, waiver days, were those on the last iteration of this? Because I'm sure I would have asked you about them at that one. Or were those put in there between the last version and this version?
You know, I cannot hear you, and I apologize.
Oh, my...
Move it up to you.
My question was the waiver and record days on January, February, March. I don't recall seeing those in the last version, because I know I would have asked this question.
Yeah, all of them were there except March 3rd was the one that was added. So we
so
have
those
four.
Were in the last iteration?
So there are four of them.
So basically that's no students, just the teachers come in. And what are the teachers doing on those days?
They're going to do professional development.
Okay. I won't ask my follow-up question now. On March 3rd, it says trimester. Is that correct?
Right. The elementaries are on trimester,
oh, okay.
So we just denote the trimesters okay. on the calendar.
Then my next question would be, I probably should have asked before, why are we doing spring break? I'm assuming spring break is late in August. Is it? Oh, wait. Spring break
no,
is... Okay, this is where I thought, okay, I didn't see the hand. I'm sorry, my apology about that. Do you, I know you're new, so you probably don't know. If you could find out, when do we begin having Good Friday off? Because I don't recall us having Good Friday off until I've been looking at the district calendar, so I'm fairly certain that's been in the last 10 years or so. I was curious, if you could research and see when we began closing for Good Friday, I'd appreciate that.
So, again, you want me to research... when we started having Good Friday
off? Yeah,
because
historically we were spring break always fluctuated, because I remember exchange between myself and Charlie Byrne 25 years ago in regard to when spring break was. My question, though, was I don't recall us having Good Friday affiliated with that. Now it is. I was just curious to see when that occurred.
Eric, for what it's worth, there was a discussion a number of years back where they were trying to align it with both other districts, and I think with the end of the semester, if I remember right, or the middle of the semester, I suppose. But part of it was, and that was a compensatory
right,
day,
oh, right.
right? It's not for Good Friday. It was
well,
a compensatory
well, it's
day.
Not, but it just coincidentally
just want to
lines
be sure
up
that,
every
that,
year.
Said yeah. correctly.
No, I understand it's compensatory. So no matter what, we have the same number of instructional days. I was just curious to see when historically we began doing that, because I'm, as you folks know, I'm always about trying to figure out.
Sure, sure. You
know, I'll check our records.
I was curious. Okay.
Absolutely.
Oh, and then I do have one. When we have the compensatory days, or I'm sorry, when we have the records days, waiver days. What if I'm a parent and I'm a single parent, or I'm a dual career family and I have an elementary child, what do I do? Do I take the day off, or is there some sort of do I have to take the day off from work because I don't have the day off from work? So I have to, I guess my question would be, what is there available for primarily elementary school parents who don't have the luxury of being at home to take care of their children? What options do we provide?
Well, as far as options, we do try to put those on the calendar ahead of time so
right.
that people are aware of them, but we they are no students, so
right.
no students are to report.
So
what parents do, they're on their own in that particular
does the city, I could recall years ago the city of Cleveland Heights on certain days, I think they had something at the rec center. I wasn't sure, do they still do that? Is it coordinated? Do we coordinate that so that folks have some sort of an option, I guess?
I don't believe so, but I don't know for sure on that
okay.
one.
Okay. Those are all my questions.
Any questions, Ron? No? Okay, anybody? Questions? No? All right, Mr. Gaynor?
Mr. Zucker?
Yes.
Mr. Posh?
Yes.
Mr. Register?
Yes.
Mr. Silverman?
Yes.
Ms. Ray?
Yes.
Okay, so the next three are approval of field trips. One, Heights High DECA Students International Career Development Conference field trip to Nashville, April 22nd through the 27th. Then the Heights High Students of Promise Morehouse field trip to Selma, Alabama, Birmingham, Alabama, and Atlanta, Georgia from May 11th through the 15th. Then the last one is Heights High Spanish Students trip to San Juan, Puerto Rico. And that's scheduled for June 27th through July 2nd, 2006.
All right. I need a motion. Oh, sorry.
July 2nd, 2016. I said 2006.
Okay, no problem. I need a motion, please.
So moved.
Second.
All right. Any questions, discussion, comments? Mr. Gaynor.
Mr. Posh.
Yes.
Mr. Register.
Yes.
Mr. Silverman.
Yes.
Ms. Wright.
Yes.
Mr. Zucker.
Yes. Do you have anything further?
No.
Okay, so we will move on. We did personnel, so we'll go to business services.
Okay, we have George Peckett and Pat O'Brien.
Okay.
Good evening. Mr. O'Brien can answer the questions if you have any on the first change orders.
Okay, and do I have to take each of the 1A, 1B, 1C, 1D separately, or
yes.
All is 1A through D?
Take them separately.
Okay, so I need a motion for 1A, change order number 30, with a total value of $75,184.30.
So moved.
Do I have a second?
I would, but I can't.
Anyone?
Second.
All right, thank you. Then questions, if you have any comments first, then we'll ask questions afterwards.
Sure. This change order is additional waterproofing that we added around the foundations of the basement. In the GMP documents, we anticipated that we would waterproof a significant portion of the foundations around the building. We had $115,000 in the contract, in the base contract for that. This is an additional $75,000, and it's really primarily driven by the fact that we found more unsuitable soils around the property. We wanted to be safe with respect to how we protected the building. It's going to be there for a very long time, and so that's chiefly what this represents.
And I assume the waterproofing we had previously was just basically a masonry wall and a bunch of dirt next to it, correct? I'm assuming a 1926 structure, there wasn't much of a waterproofing.
Well, different methods, different construction methods and approaches. Okay. So we are a little bit more specific and careful how we approach things today.
Gotcha. Very diplomatic.
As Paul noted, the audio is not great over here from you guys.
Okay. Yeah, speak a little louder.
Very diplomatic.
Okay. Thank you.
Other questions about this one? Comments?
You know, I am really, really starting to get uncomfortable approving these change orders without having a detailed accounting of the project. And I know that Eric and I are meeting with basically staff, the architects, and PMC to try to get a better handle of that on Friday. You know, I'm gonna vote on these because, you know, I know I've read through them, they're all important, but I think it's time that we really, really start looking very, very closely. I mean, the change orders are starting to mount. The project is very, very important to us in the community. And that's why Eric and I are meeting with PMC and Regency.
Well, I have a suggestion or thought. I think I'd talk with Cal, but we can probably do that. Probably be new business or other business. So.
Yes. Okay.
But I think if you just clarify for them that these change orders have already been done,
The changes we're going to discuss this evening, there is one scope of work that hasn't been executed.
Gotcha.
That I will talk about in the next change order 31.
Okay.
And I have a question for the board for their input.
Thank
But the work on the other ones is either work that has been done or work that we are forced by existing conditions to do, not optional. There is one piece of work I will talk about in change order 31 that you have an option.
Gotcha.
Well, and as we had this, it was explained at the last or one of the last or two FAC meetings ago, is that there's a very laborious process as far as documentation and certification for all this stuff. I mean, they showed me when I was questioning the dirt, this binder filled with every single ticket. So it's it's a procedural. I hate to say it, it's procedural to a high degree. So.
Oh yeah, I'm not suggesting any.
Oh right.
I'm not even sure what word I want to use, but I mean, we've been through this before.
Right.
So yeah, I know that everything's documented. The work's been done. It was necessary.
Right.
No questions right. about that. I mean, there's plenty of documentation, but you know, sort of eats into our contingency,
right.
and we just need to look at the big picture.
I agree.
That's
right.
And you said you were going to mention something to address that, so
yeah.
Fine.
So do you want okay. any more, you know, the vote, or?
Yeah, as long as no other comments yeah. about this one. Okay, then Mr. Gaynor.
Mr. Register.
Yes.
Mr. Silverman.
Yes.
Ms. Wright.
Yes.
Mr. Zucker.
Yes.
Mr. Posh.
Yes.
All right, I need a motion for item 1B, change order number 31.
So moved.
Second.
Go ahead.
Change order 31, we had parts of the building that we had to remove that we did not originally contemplate. There was concrete work, there was some additional steel work. The steel work was supplementing existing steel to some of the existing structure. There were places when we opened up walls, we thought there would be more structural support between existing stairs and we were gonna have connections to the new building. So there's a lot of steel in there. Some adjustments to site work to go around some unforeseen subsurface conditions so that our pipe routings, again, would make sure that all of our utilities flowed. The one piece of work that we haven't done that is in this change order that as a board, you certainly are welcome to comment on is inside the building, when you walk in the main entrance, to your left, there'll be a piece of steel that runs from the first floor, second floor, third floor. And what the architect has drawn is covering that in a column surround. Basically, it's a piece of steel. We'd put a box around it, and we could either leave it as drywall, try to make it look a little nicer. We could also put brick around it. And this change order includes approximately $22,000 to put brick around that column. It's in two locations. One, when you walk through the main vestibule on the left, and then at the other end, if you go all the way down that main corridor, like you were walking past the auditorium, before you make a left to go down the hallway that would parallel the football field, it's the same column exists there. So we could leave it as a drywall finish, or we could put brick around it. This change order would put brick around those two columns to make them look nicer inside the building.
Well, I'm pretty familiar with the structure. I'm trying to figure out where we have a three-story column.
It goes through from the first floor to the second floor to the third floor. And correct me if I'm wrong, John. Our architect is with us. This one goes on A and F. It goes all the way up to three.
Yeah, it goes all the way up to three.
Yeah.
And as you enter
from the east side. I'm coming in from the east lobby, the main entrance. I walk in the building. Okay, I'm in the lobby, the foyer, whatever we want to call it.
Okay. On the left side.
Okay.
There's a column and a door to the south.
Oh. Oh, the door by the security office.
That's correct.
Okay, so right now we have a column that's exposed.
Right now we have a couple of gift boards.
Okay.
We're driving, and there's the opportunity in this change order to cover it with brick that would
have to. Well, you're talking of three stories of masonry? Well, because then I guess the question would be, I'm for it. The question I would pose is, previously when I did a tour of the structure, there was a discussion as far as what that wall was going to be. So I guess
this is just the column, Eric.
Well, I understand that, but my point being is, if you had at that juncture, I was being told it's going to be drywall. So if the wall is drywall and then you get this column of masonry, that would seem a little odd. I'm comfortable with going with this masonry if we're doing more of what we had seen previously, which was supposed to be a masonry wall as opposed to a drywall, because this is the main entrance for the structure, so it should look a little nicer than, you know, an office cubicle. So I'm comfortable with it, but I would be curious to see how it's going to fit in the context of the other work we're doing in that space.
Yeah, and I don't have an illustration
right.
of that here.
Oh,
for
right.
You.
I understand. I just, you know, I think hopefully, well, if we have the meeting on Friday, hopefully we could get the clarity on
we
that.
We can go through some very specific details of how that fits in with the other finishes in that interior.
And now, I highlighted here, you had reference to revisions to stair tower structures, which is in the change order or summation we have here. Which stair tower structures are we talking about? Are we talking the two new staircases, or are we talking the 1926 staircases?
John, do you want to, which staircases? We have steel in various staircases that we had to supplement. But Eric wanted to know, is it the two grand stairs, or are these, we have other existing staircases that are in various components of the building. John, you want to come up?
Yeah.
Because it, just easier. What it reads here, the pertinent part, steel beam adjustments throughout the building, blah, 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 with supplemental steel to account for both existing conditions and design modifications to accommodate changing equipment locations or other revisions to stair tower structures. I know it's already 9:30 and we're getting into minutia, but it's...
So we've got a number of stair towers.
Yeah, most of this occurred at the stairs adjacent to the auditorium, the existing stairs.
I didn't see any modifications when you guys were... what's going on? What is that?
Well, it's how the new building's connected to the old building at those locations.
Oh, so it's attaching the new construction to the old.
Yeah, the stair that you see there.
Right.
We got to tie stuff into.
Oh,
that.
So basically, it's a matter of connecting the new construction to the old, like you had those.
That's okay. Correct. And as Pat said, when they started to do demolition, some of the structure that appeared in documentation either wasn't there or was compromised.
Okay, so it's more about connecting the new construction to the old. Okay, that was my only question on that.
Okay. Anything else? Anybody? Okay, Mr. Gaynor.
Mr. Silverman.
Yes.
Ms. Wright.
Yes.
Mr. Zucker.
Yes.
Mr. Posh.
Yes.
Mr. Register.
Yes.
I need a motion for item E1C, change order number 32.
So moved.
Okay, similar to change order 30.
Oh, we need a second.
Oh, I'm sorry. I apologize.
All right, thank you. Go ahead.
Similar to change order 31, we had problems inside the existing building trying to fit new equipment. And the biggest chunk of this was we made some adjustments to the air handlers. Instead of having five, we had two that were a little bit bigger. So we saved some money on the air handlers, but we had to cut some very large holes in the floors in areas F and area A, so that we can make sure air got up and down through those. And again, this nets out to a plus on this side. There was a minus on the HVAC contract that you don't see here. We also found, we talked about this before, but it includes the cost for removing the underground storage tank that was over in the auto tech area. A little bit more asbestos in this one. Of the $223,000, there's a chunk of that is including some asbestos that we found under area A when we took some of that slab out.
The holes you're cutting in the floors, I guess on the air handler, net, is it saving us money or is it more because you wanted it work? It's greater efficiency.
Well, it's a very good question, Eric. When we bought the air handlers, we changed the design to have a better price on our HVAC package, but we bid that as a number separate from knowing what this cost was going to be to the concrete. So I don't think we got, and correct me if I'm wrong, folks from the CMR team, but I don't think we got a price for the five air handlers. We knew if we went to the two, we would save money in that net price, but I didn't get give me a pre-price versus a post-price. So it's very difficult to calculate. The assumption would be that the idea was we're going to save money, but I don't have an exact figure on what that would have been.
And so I guess just because how big are these holes? It said about the size.
They're very large. These ones were, what were the dimensions? Do you remember the dimensions on we're talking about the big slabs we had to cut?
The big slabs.
They were like 45, 50 feet in one dimension. I think they were, this is why there was a lot of steel and concrete involved. Okay. It wasn't just, normally you think a plenum space, you're cutting a hole the size you put a chair through. These are, I think they had to go at least two whole bays of concrete across, and it was like a large L shape. I thought it was like 50 feet in one direction, 30 feet in another direction.
Okay. Then you must have cut those relatively soon, because when we toured the building, I didn't see.
I don't think we've, have we cut those already? Scott, did we cut those?
All but the second floor.
Okay, so they're cut. We can take you out there and show them.
No, I didn't see it. That's all. Okay.
Anything else? Mr. Gaynor?
Ms. Wright?
Yes.
Mr. Zucker?
Yes.
Mr. Posh?
Yes.
Mr. Register?
Yes.
Mr. Silverman?
Yes.
I need a motion for E1D, change order 33.
So moved.
Second.
33 was driven by a lot of discussions we had before we prepared the GMP documents about keep the clay tile, don't keep the clay tile. Ultimately, as you know, we're keeping the clay tile on the first floor, and as well as the second floor. The documents still show us protecting and keeping on the third floor. We may change that, but the GMP documents did not show the level of detail that we currently anticipate. As a consequence, we had to ask the contractor to make sure they protected that floor. And this is a cost associated with making sure we protected it in the event that we wanted to keep 100% of it. This happened very early in the project, ASI number one. It was the first post-GMP document we issued to the folks on the CMR team to make sure, again, that we had we maintained the integrity of the tile floor in those corridors on 1, 2, and 3 in the 1926 portion of the building.
I have questions, but not on this one, sir.
Okay. Yep. Mr. Gaynor?
Mr. Zucker?
Yes.
Mr. Posh?
Yes.
Mr. Register?
Yes.
Mr. Silverman?
Yes.
Mr. Wright?
Yes.
You want questions now about
the... Yeah, because they're at the mic. We haven't gotten updates from you folks. I know Gil Bain's in the audience. We didn't get updates the last 2 weeks. I was curious as to where we'll have one this week as well.
I know Aaron was on vacation for a week.
No, we know last 2 weeks, and then this will be the third week.
The Friday before he left, we didn't get one out.
Okay, cool. Then my other questions, which I emailed myself, fortunately. When do we anticipate getting the plan for the dirt on the east field? What's the ETA on that?
Oh, we have it. The dirt should start moving. Okay. The weather's not, we're hoping the weather was good this week. It would have been coming out this week.
Okay. I guess another fun Gil Bain. When do we anticipate a I'll ask this ahead of facilities accountability. When will be adding a second sign to the exterior? We have one right in front. If you live on Kildare, it's great. But if we can get signs at Goodnor and Cedar and Lee, so when people are driving by, they know what's going on. So I know FAC's going to ask for that, so I'm wondering when that's going
to occur. We have to go back to the ABR and zoning for that, so we can discuss that, I think.
Discuss on Friday?
Offline, yeah.
Okay. Another one. The stadium cam. Now that the roof is up, you really have no value from the stadium cam because you can't see anything different. Are we going to move the stadium cam, or as I was told, it's very expensive, can we take it down and get some money back for that? There's no point in having a streaming live feed for the next year if all it's going to show is the roof.
That wouldn't be a very good, and that's not a great feed. I would defer that to...
You can't, unless you, we could debate it. You can't really see much because of the fisheye, but okay, it's like a lot of money. That's why I was like, I'd rather spend the money on something else. And then...
We'll look at options of putting it at a different location.
Just angle it down a little more, I guess. And then, let's see... that's very nice. And then the last one would be if we could start seeing, because we're looking at now, I think it'd be high value in the, I'm curious to see the at least preliminary our schedule for the summer 2017, how we're going to move out of this building into the high school and the middle schools. I'm very curious to see that, and in particular, repurposing of furniture, because I know from touring the middle schools, I think there's a tremendous amount of furniture and equipment that we can repurpose and save a lot of money. And now I toured the building here as well. There's very comparable, the middle school furniture to the high school furniture is very comparable. So I'd be very curious to see a schedule, at least a preliminary one, of how we anticipate to be done, how we're doing everything in the summer of 17.
We're just working through some of the furniture plan now and seeing what we're going to procure, how that matches up with our budget. I don't think that the folks on the BSHM team have looked at, I know they've looked at all of our existing furniture in the high school. I don't know that they've had a chance to visit our middle schools to do any evaluations of that furniture. But we're just starting to get into that right now, Eric, about the complications of how we're going to manage that.
I believe I emailed, I believe we were, so in the next few months, we're supposed to be really getting into that sort of detail. And again, my point being is that from touring the building, what the cost of a chair is, the tables, I saw a significant amount of furniture that, in my opinion, the bus drivers are always looking for work in the summers, hire some bus drivers and rent some box trucks and move stuff from the middle schools to the high school. I saw easily six-figure, in nice six figures that we could save. So I'm hopeful to see. I'm very curious to see how that's going to play out.
Yeah, we're certainly going to investigate all potential strategies to be as cost-effective and as efficient as possible in our move, particularly given the fact that it was less than optimal as we moved into this building.
My feeling is the more that we don't have to move from here back there, I think the better for all parties involved, especially George, because he's shaking his head yes. Those are all my questions.
Good. Rob, anything?
No.
I'm good. Anybody over here? So just you heard both Jim and Eric mention, but look, there's something close to $750,000 of change orders on this tonight. I think just listening to what the other board members said and knowing what we need, I just need to reinforce our need for timely and accurate information. And it really is not acceptable any other way. These type of things, as you heard in the earlier discussion here, this community is fairly strapped, and we really do need to know things as early as possible. To that end, and we can talk about a new business, but I did ask Jim and Eric, since they are our liaisons to Facilities Accountability Committee, to start becoming a liaison in terms of change orders, to meet with you guys on a regular basis. It'd be a much more streamlined communication channel that way. And then you can get decisions more quickly. Now, the board has to make the decisions, but they will be our communication channel in between. And so remember also change orders, and this is probably a problem I had in my thinking was I always thought of change orders in terms of things that cost us money. But there are change orders that save us money because of value engineering, but might create substantive differences that we may need to know about, because if it's something that we feel doesn't make sense, you're going to need to hear from us as early as possible.
Certainly, and one of the things that, I mean, we've made tens of thousands of decisions going into the design of this high school, and that doesn't mean that we still don't have a lot of decisions we have to make, and you know, to every extent possible, before we make a decision that impacts adding cost to the project, we want to bring that to the board. Again, we're still chasing down the preponderance of what we've talked about this evening are things that we had to do and that have happened. We still have a few more of those to bring to you next month. Hopefully we can clean most of those up next month, certainly by June. But you'll see a shift in us asking more questions to the board about here are work scope options with respect to potential upgrades or potential ways to save money. Does it impact adversely the educational program or the long-term operational use of the building? So those are the kind of things that we're always considering. Are there ways that we can still maintain value in the building, save a little bit of money? We've exhausted quite a few of those options already, but you'll see more of those things coming to the board in as we bring additional change orders to you.
Right, and as I know you know by now, we're a cake and eat it too community, so we expect an absolutely gorgeous set of buildings, but at the same time, we expect you to pay attention to the budget, and we expect you to pay attention to the timeline. So
and be
having the two board members meeting with you, I think will make it a little bit easier for a quicker turnaround.
Looking forward to being able to participate in that process. Yes.
All right.
It'll make the meeting shorter, that's for sure.
Well, we're not really counting on it.
I mean, we're going to talk a little bit more about this.
We'll talk about new business. Yeah, I just wanted to give them the insight of that.
Good.
So, all right, thank you very much. Mr. Petkak, if you could stay, I think the others can go home and be with their families. I need a motion for item E2, recommendation to approve quarterly contracts.
So moved.
Second.
All right, Mr. Petkak, anything to tell us or any questions for Mr. Petkak? Mr. Gaynor.
Mr. Posh.
Yes.
Mr. Register.
Yes.
Mr. Silverman.
Yes.
Ms. Wright.
Yeah.
Mr. Zucker.
Yes. Okay. And then item E3, recommendation to accept the list of donations below with our sincere thanks. A motion, please.
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Any questions, comments? Mr. Gaynor.
Mr. Register.
Yes.
Mr. Silverman.
Yes.
Ms. Wright.
Yes.
Mr. Zucker.
Yes.
Mr. Posh.
Yes.
All right, Mr. Petkak, you got off easy. Thank you very much. All right, which moves us on to item F, finance. Mr. Gaynor, take all of them together? Or all four?
No, the three.
Oh, I'm sorry, all three. I'm sorry, my mistake. So I need a motion for items F1 through 3.
So moved.
Second.
All right, any questions, comments? Mr. Gainer, you have any comments?
I will note the for the new board members, the approval of tax rate resolution is an annual exercise where you're required, or the board is required, to approve the tax rates that the county gives us. And I suppose otherwise they wouldn't levy the taxes that were due, so that happens once a year. Nothing else?
Okay, Mr. Gainer, the roll.
Mr. Silverman?
Yes.
Ms. Wright?
Yes.
Mr. Zucker?
Yes.
Mr. Posh?
Yes.
Mr. Register?
Yes.
All right, we move on to financial update. Mr. Gainer.
Yeah, just a couple of quick items. One, I wanted to mention that the CAFR is complete. And so we do have this out on the website. Thank you, Mr. Wortman. And so that is available under the Treasures tab. You can go out and take a look at that beautiful and hence the name, comprehensive document. I will also mention, and I've included in your packet, an exchange between the administration of the district and Ohio Department of Education. Because, in particular, first to apprise you of that, but also to let you know, because I think some of the conversation around the RIFs there's been a lot of financial discussion about the savings, and some suggestion that perhaps the savings would preclude us from having to be on the ballot for a levy. So I wanted to make sure that we, you know, kind of ran through this exchange with ODE, because Ohio Department of Education reviews the five-year forecast that we submit in October and in May. So they looked at our October 15 forecast and noted a negative unreserved fund balance of greater than 2%. So they are statutory obligated, when they see a deficit like that, to ask us to prepare a plan and what we intend to do to address that deficit. And then we are statutory obligated to, you know, submit a proposal. So you see their letter to us asking for a proposal, and then you also see a response, which is just a very high level response suggesting that in order to address the looming deficits, we did put a levy on the ballot in May, which was unsuccessful. There were some resulting reductions because we did not want to go back in that same November because the city was on the ballot for their income tax. Then we do also note that there would be some estimated savings from a reduction in force, because that process, again, it started all the way back in October. Mm-hmm. And so we knew that was happening. We just, you know, didn't know to what degree. And then also it suggests that we would indeed have a levy on the ballot this fall. And then you see Ohio Department of Education's response to us saying that the plan is approved as submitted, and that they strongly encourage, the letter is directed to Dr. Dixon, strongly encourage you to work with your treasurer and school board to ensure that the necessary measures are fully implemented and that you stay within your forecasted plan to prevent deficits in future fiscal years. So I just wanted to put that out there, because again, I was hearing some information, you know, in terms of you know, was this a purely financial decision in terms of the RIFs, and would that decision preclude us from being back on the ballot? And so the answer is no, and as we indicated to ODE, it would be a combination. That certainly the RIFs have a financial impact and would affect the millage that would be necessary, or the length of that resulting levy, but that was all conversation that we would be having in May as part of our overall work session on school finance and school funding. That's also the time that we would approve a new five-year forecast that would include all the reductions that have been made. And in addition to that, then we would be in a position to have the levy conversation that we need to have. And I also wanted to let you know that I did reach out to Jane Geneva, who is has offered to co-present with me at that meeting. So
Jane being the
chair of the Life Finance Committee. So she will be here in May to co-present. She has a great knowledge of school funding and school finance. So I thought that would be a good thing to have her as a resource, and we'll go from there. It can answer any questions or anything about that. I just wanted to get it out there, because we have had some conversations about it.
So we don't have a date yet?
A date yet?
For the committee to meet. They're gonna meet?
We're trying to get them together in April.
After the meeting in May?
No, we're trying to get them together in April so that they can, when we bring Jane in and meet with you in May, we can have a conversation about that. Because really, as Jim has mentioned before, we are We are on a deadline, and there are statutory requirements if the board is putting a levy on the ballot in November. We have to work back from there, so.
Okay. So the composition of the lay finance committee is going to essentially, I mean, I can't see how it can change, so I guess this
yeah,
is sort
it
of
would
like
just
a
be who sits
discussion,
there now,
but
right. And I think we've committed to have some conversation about what that would look like moving forward. But for this purpose, I would recommend that it be, you know, with your seat remaining vacant, obviously, because you can't be on the committee, although you are the board liaison, I think you and Ron both.
Do we actually have a policy where the Lay Finance Committee actually has to meet to approve?
No.
Yeah.
No.
That committee is just, it's been in existence since, actually, Ms. Ressiger, when she came forward and said she's been involved since 88, it's been around that long.
Yeah.
And she was an original member of that group, I believe. And it's just been a standing committee that's kind of
advisory.
Outside and advisory of
yeah.
But they traditionally have come together and reviewed the five-year forecast just to look at the assumptions of the forecast and you know, come to before the board and suggest whether or not the five-year forecast is reasonable, whether the assumptions are reasonable, and whether they demonstrate the need for a levy. And then to recommend what millage they see, and then the board goes from there.
Scott, I'm real happy that you shared this dialogue with the Department of Education. I mean, I really wish that many of the folk here that were, you know, frankly upset this evening was able to share this, and maybe I should have brought it up in my long-winded dialogue, but I guess maybe not. But I mean, the issue here is, if we can't balance our books and show we can balance our books for 5 years with existing revenue and existing staffing, I mean, we're done. I mean, the state could essentially shut us down. And I don't think that's really recognized. And this past year, I mean, the state basically said you needed to have a plan because you were in the red. And if we don't approve your plan, I mean, there's, I'm sure, documented.
Yeah, as well as they suggest yeah. in the letter, we would first go into fiscal caution and then proceed from there. So you get to that point where the state actually comes in and they put you at all those standards, minimum standards that we want to avoid.
Well, yeah, they would
take
make
the
local decision.
Control out and make the decision.
Yeah, and you talk about class size. I mean, the class size then is just, I mean, they're going to.
Yes.
Yeah, we know our community expects a lot, and we give our community a lot. But when
Absolutely.
The state comes in, it's going to be very different than what our community would want to expect. Thanks for preparing all
oh,
this.
Oh, absolutely.
I would absolutely love, I mean, for me personally,
sure.
I mean, this financial report that you provide, the balance sheet, I mean, the statement of funds, I mean, I know it needs to be documented in the record. I would much rather see that replaced with a five-year forecast, even if it's the same every single month. I mean, I just think it's something that is an important document we as board members need to, I mean, we have to look 5 years into the future, money-wise, every single time we meet, because that's really our primary role. And I just think, you know, of all the financial documents that you provide, that is certainly on the
well, and we could absolutely include that. And in fact, there's, you know, although it didn't rise to the level of necessarily having you approve it, we did when we met with the unions back in October, November, and went through the five-year forecast with them. There was a change to health care. We had some significant increases that weren't in the October forecast that we did put in a kind of a projection for them so that they could see what that was. So, you know, if we were to bring the forecast to you on a monthly basis, we would have just put that in there and have you approve it. So,
yeah,
we can absolutely do that. And then hopefully if we get the new software that we're working through with the state, because the state software does not provide a very robust and informative kind of a report that we can more easily get you some more meaningful data.
Yeah.
So.
Well, I mean, these cuts got to be awful for them, and you know, it's. I mean, I think we all know that.
Yeah.
So I mean, I think anything that you present to them at this point, they're going to be
yeah,
still reeling in them.
Yeah. Okay.
And one of the things we, at the meeting that Ron and Dr. Dixon and I were at last night, they were talking about the impact not only of Ed Choice, but also of the, in our case, I think, the Peterson scholarships. And so,
yes.
So it may be interesting to start highlighting some of these things that are somewhat beyond our control, or they're more than somewhat beyond our control, but how these are things that we have to pay that really don't impact the students in our district. So.
Yeah.
I like Jim's idea of having the five-year forecast available.
Mm-hmm. So, we'll do.
All right. Anyone else have anything on this? All right. I'm going to move on to my president's report. You know, I thought about the president's report a lot, and now it falls on either deaf ears or virtually no ears, frankly, at this point. But you know, I was thinking about tonight's meeting and all the different messages that we were covering tonight, and I want to see how the different messages sort of fit together, because we talked about aligning our resources to our enrollment, which is led to the reduction in force, the need to address our budget, which led to the levy discussion, the needs of our facilities, which led to the change order discussion, how we want to change our communication stream. I'm going to start with something that again, maybe would fall on deaf ears because of the decision we came to tonight. But one of the great things about the education profession is it is one of the true people professions. It is the successes that are gained in this profession, maybe more than any other, are through talented people who are working their best for just the right reasons. And almost all the time, that's a beautiful thing. Commensurately, the vast majority of our budget, about 80% of our budget, the resources is apportioned to people. So while it's great that this is such a people profession, this is makes nights like tonight extremely difficult. We don't have a lot of areas where we can save the money, and as Dr. Dixon said, this is also just about aligning an organization, making an optimally sized organization an efficient organization. I want to take a moment to recognize all the people who are affected by our decision tonight and thank them for the work that they've provided to our district as well. This is about people. This absolutely is about people. And our action tonight in no way reflects on the contributions they made to us. It is an organizational decision. I appreciate, Dr. Dixon, I appreciate your recommendation was about, you're right, it's about aligning our resources. And I really appreciated the inclusiveness of the process you took, you know, including not just front office administration, but principals, and then actually involving union leadership is a great thing. I mean, you're trying to come up with a robust way to do things. Decisions were made, decisions were challenged, decisions were made again, and this was not done in a vacuum. This was done with a lot of different perspectives, and we really appreciate it. I most appreciate that they were taken, will make our district more efficient without compromising program integrity. The people who've been on the board with me long enough know that every single time we get to a cuts discussion, that's the first question. And although it's always brought up and said, it has to be said again and again. It's very important that people realize in the end, the most important thing is that we're providing what our children need, what our community's children need. And thank you for verifying that. And then beyond just the alignment of resources, we have a statutory obligation to address budget shortfalls in the five-year forecast, as Mr. Gaynor just said. And, you know, as we all know, the unconstitutional Ohio funding model makes the challenges even greater, which leads directly into the next thing we talked about, which, well, maybe not in order, but is the levy. And because of our fiscal situation, it is clear, and as we're talking now, and although we have not voted to put an issue on the ballot, we will need to be on the ballot this year. It's good that we are having the Lay Finance Committee meet this month, you said, and then having a discussion about this in May. We will decide what the millage is, we'll decide what the timing is, although, you know, it seems obvious, but let's let the Lay Finance Committee give us some sort of counsel on that as well. And then the facilities discussion, I mean, realizing that we are being faced with dealing with things that aren't necessarily in our bailiwick. You know, Mr. Silverman, you've done an excellent job of picking up and really, really asking a lot of really difficult questions and important questions. But these change orders, the changes that are made that affect the budget in a negative way, changes that are made that affect the project in some way that may seem like value-added engineering to some people may not seem like value-added engineering to us. Please understand we need to have a very, very strong communication stream. And so I think having this new vehicle will really help us in that way as well.
So overall, I mean, I guess I'm looking at the competing pressures. We have declining enrollment and the responsibility to optimize our resources. We have a statutory mandate to show an annual to show a balanced budget. We have the core organizational function of providing a robust education to all of our students. And this is all wrapped, and I wrote this, in the specter of a legislatively public education hostile environment, unfairly funded by an over-reliance on property taxes and unrealistically, unethically, and inequitably mandated by our state legislature. And although that seems like a lot of jargon, it's all true. And every one of us knows it, and every one of this community knows it. So what ties all of this together for me is the word sustainability. And when we went through this whole process, we always talked about environmental sustainability, which is probably the most popular use of the term sustainability. But for years now, I guess I've always kept trying to put a bigger focus on the greater sustainability, which is sure environmental, but also programmatic sustainability, fiscal sustainability, organizational sustainability, and educational sustainability. Because the educational business model as it currently exists is not a sustainable model, period, exclamation mark. So part of our obligation is to do what we can to shift the balance towards sustainability. And the reason is, we are not only responsible for the students we have today, we are responsible for the students who are going to come after we're no longer on the board. Maybe the administration's changed, although you may be here, I don't know. But we are responsible for the students of today and the students of tomorrow. And that's why tonight's actions were necessary. So those are my comments. We can move on then to unfinished business. Any unfinished business, I can't think of any, and especially at this hour. New business, does anyone have anything before we discuss that one, the one thing we already mentioned we're going to discuss? Any other new business? All right, so you know, I will open up to each of you felt like you wanted to say something, but the bottom line is really what I've already stated, which we will create this liaison group, which would be, in this case, the two of you. But go ahead, either one of you.
I just think that's just a matter of we need to, I think, to Jim, myself, and the design team, who any of them are still here, George is over there. We'll put it on George. Basically, to come up with a methodology to start meeting on a regular basis to really, I think, dive into the details and share a lot of that with you folks. Shorten my Q&A. So hopefully, you know, come up with something more. It's theoretically akin to some of our other sort of standing committees. So, and I'll let Jim do the comments since I already have, like, you know, all the other ones to talk about.
Go ahead, Jim. Okay.
Well, I mean, I think the issue here is we had some legal reason to meet with a lawyer who sort of looked at the process. And it was one of the executive sessions that we were in, and to be completely transparent. And his recommendation was to look at the process of how change orders and how decisions are being made. And the general thought was we need to pick an amount. I think the amount that he picked or suggested was $25,000. You have two board members really dig into the decisions that are being made, such as is there a mezzanine for the pool, the brick issues. We sort of vet those out. We present that to the board. The board votes on these changes. It just sort of eliminates a lot of sort of gray area that I think exists right now, because there's no policy for this of how these decisions are getting made. So what I would like to, I guess, propose is let's not pick an amount now. I would certainly like to have Dr. Dixon's opinion of what that amount should be. I mean, maybe it's 25. You know, maybe that number, because of this size project, is not going to work. But I think we need to talk to the design team. And Eric and I have a meeting set with them on Friday to really start digging into this. I think as part of that process, we're going to look at the FAC, where they fit in, and come back with some thoughts that we can discuss that would help fuel your meeting. And I think we do that with staff. And, you know, staff right now has been sort of driving a lot of this, and they still need to drive this. I mean, they're the educational experts when it comes to, I mean, the kind of programs that we deliver. But we're getting to a stage where there are a lot of changes we're finding. I mean, if it wasn't for this big ski hill now that we have, which is costing us $1 million.
It's not costing us that much. The numbers are coming in much lower than that. No.
Well, I'm glad. But I'm glad you know that. But not. I mean, you're really. I mean, but I want to know that, and I think we all need to have that kind of information.
And I think that goes. I think the issue is to a degree that my take on it, and I don't mean to beg the hour, is that I think it's more. It's an issue of because of the complexity of this project and the. As we saw this evening from our constituency, I think the expectations of the project, I think that the more the board has a very good sense of what's going on with the project, we are ultimately are responsible for it. And for myself, and I can't speak for my colleagues, but for me, if my name's going to be on some plaque in the lobby till 50 years from now, another board of ed pries it off and puts a new one on, we have to have a sense of ownership. And I think the more that we know what's going on, the more we can convey it to the community and the public, because that's what we're here to do. And in particular, you know, we have a number of elements where we need to make sure that people's expectations, our expectations to the community's expectations, are met. And so I think we have to have that degree of ownership. So the more that we can, as you know, I think Jim and myself can then ask questions, convey them to the board, and ask the staff. I think the better we have with the process, and not have all five of us in a room bombarding them with questions. We can bore down to the detail, and then again also see how we can utilize fact better in that process going forward.
I appreciate it. And just to be clear, I'll just say this just to say it, is the purpose of this is not to create a stream for micromanagement. Yep. It is to create a stream for communication. Yep. And there's a fine line that we walk on this. I mean, every board member I've ever known, sorry to all of you, has, and me included, has crossed that line. So be very I would ask you both to be very careful about that, but to please, the communication stream is critical. So there's that. The other thing I'm just going to say, and there was nothing wrong with what you said, because it would, Mr. Friedman did present that to us a different time as well. Transparency is transparency. Executive sessions are communications that are not to be shared with anyone. So I want to be sure for our new board members especially, nothing that goes on in the executive session should be shared out to public. That is the law. So I mean, that's an ethics issue. So having said that, you did nothing wrong. So I'm not reprimanding.
No,
I just want to be sure.
No. Yeah,
so be clear, please, Jim. Let me finish. Be clear that transparency has its limits. I mean, people want to use the word transparency as a positive all the time. Don't be transparent to the point where you're violating any sort of rules. So that's the one thing I would just offer.
I'll be very careful about
Thank you. I do appreciate that. So we'll move on to board committee reports then. Anyone?
All right, that's me. And this is going out to Nancy Dietrich in the 15th row, because I can see her and Alan Wilkinson and George Petkak, and that's the only people I can see left.
Someone sitting there.
So this goes, okay, the Alumni Foundation's Pancake Breakfast is April 17th. I look forward to seeing all of you there. It'll actually be here in Wiley. It's all you can eat pancakes. Russell's Coffee, John Hubbard's donating. He's donating the coffee. It's all you can eat, great pancakes. And for those of you who haven't had an opportunity to tour the building, there'll be tours as well for the citizens. That's going more for Mark Brown with the camera over there. The Alumni Hall of Fame induction ceremony is on April 28th. I hope to see my colleagues on the board there, and I hope to see as many administrators as possible there as well. That would be very nice. Cleveland Heights has a master planning committee meeting coming up on Thursday. I'll be sitting on that, tell you what's going on with that. We should find out what's going on with University Heights' committee. So I don't know, whoever's got a good rapport with them, it'd be nice to know, hey, what are you doing? Mm-hmm. Also, on that lines, I'm curious to see when we're gonna have our next meeting with Cleveland City Council.
Then
Facilities Accountability Committee, their next meeting, you can see on the agenda, is April 23rd. They did not have one last month or whatever. So those would be all of my committees.
All right.
Just a question to you, Cal. The CTE committee, I'm on the CTE committee, and that meeting's tomorrow.
Okay. Are you able to go?
No, I'm asking you.
Oh, you know, I'm going to have to check that in. Okay. I don't have it in front of me. But yeah, that sounds right, but I got to be honest, I'm not remembering off the top of my head.
notices.
Are you not on the email list?
Yes, I'm on the email.
Okay, yes. Yeah, so, yeah. Well, I'll check and I'll give you a call tomorrow. Mm-hmm. Yeah, to let you know. So.
Isn't there a spelling bee coming up?
Yes, so that was the. Thank you, Jim. Look at you. Yes, so I believe it's April 20th. Mm-hmm. I believe we're fielding a team. Are we fielding a team?
I will be unavailable to attend. It'll be my birthday, so my parents won't let me go. Sorry.
Okay.
I am very dyslexic. We're going to lose big time if I'm anywhere near it.
I'm a judge. Well,
just saying.
She's going to help you. She's going to. This is just a disaster. This is a disaster.
Maybe we could sponsor the student cadre or something like that.
We'll talk offline about this, but it is April 20th. It's a great event. I imagine all of you know about it. It's a wonderful event in the community. Yeah. It's April 20th. I'm actually the photographer yet again this year.
You have to wear bee costumes.
You don't have to.
You have to. No.
It's your birthday.
No. You have to wear the bee costume, like the ones from Saturday Night Live.
Okay. All right. We're going to move on to another committee report that I'm not on, but I do need to give you a quick report on the FAC committee after appointing Patrick Mullen as a replacement person. He's moving to California. His wife got an outstanding job, and so he's off. But my recommendation is we do not replace him at this moment in time. Okay. We're going to have a discussion that includes talking about the FAC in May. We can discuss
that. Does he have documentation about this move? Can we veto that?
You can't veto his move. Yeah. So
he didn't tell me that.
Yeah. Yeah. So. And it came up quickly, and they're very excited, and we wish them all the best. Patrick and his whole family have been tremendous contributors to the community. So, all right, any correspondence and announcements? Okay, then with that, I'll take a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Mr. Gaynor.
Mr. Bosch.
Yes.
Mr. Register.
Yes.
Mr. Silverman.
Yes.
Ms. Ray.
Yes.
Mr. Zucker.
Yes.